Newell find it.
The following is a production of Hometown and Home Country Radio Sports.
We've never seen a team like this before, ladies and gentlemen. After all this time, Bishop Garrigan is still golden. Bishop Garrigan has finally slain the Newell Fonda Dragon. Your Golden Bears are state champions for the second year in a row.
This place is packed, and it is going to be rocking in here tonight. Crooks taps it backwards, and we are underway. Buckle your seatbelts, everyone. In the lane, Crooks, center of the paint. Oh, a nice spin move, and she lays it in.
Oh, with her left hand, she claps the hands and says, let's go. You got to feed Audie this last 2 minutes.
Three-pointer is blocked at the buzzer, and that's it. After coming so close the past 2 years, Bishop Garrigan has finally won it all.
Video streaming on the Algona Radio YouTube channel is brought to you by Kemna Auto Center. It's not just about the car, it's about the care. Algona Municipal Utilities, community owned for community benefits. Bauer Plumbing and Heating of Emmitsburg and Algona. Iowa State Bank, helping people succeed. Algona Frame and Auto Body, we meet by accident. PMC Advantage Insurance, having the advantage makes all the difference. Now, here's Sports Director Tyler Lance.
We welcome you to 2024. We do it with a highly anticipated top of Iowa West basketball matchup. It's the Class 3A number 7, Forest City Indians, a perfect 10-0 on the season against the Class 1A number 8, Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears, coming in at 9-1. Most importantly, both teams 6-0 in top of Iowa West play, battling for that top of conference supremacy. Both teams have historic win streaks on the line tonight for Bishop Garrigan. They've won 62 games in a row in the top of Iowa West, dating back to early 2020. Meanwhile, Forest City, with one more win, would set a program record for most wins in a row in the 5-on-5 era of high school basketball. So a lot on the line tonight, and a lot to be learned about both these schools here in Forest City, Iowa, with tonight's conference matchup. We'll talk with both head coaches, Bishop Garrigan coach Brandon Schwab and Forest City head coach Matt Erpeling, here on the pregame show. And we'll start things off right now with Coach Schwab's pregame thoughts.
High school basketball coming up on Hometown Radio KLGA and the Algona Radio YouTube stream as the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears visit the Forest City Indians. As right now, we welcome Bishop Garrigan head coach Brandon Schwab to the pregame show. Coach, first of all, Happy New Year, and thank you for joining on the pregame show today.
Yeah, Happy New Year. Happy to be back playing games again.
And obviously, speaking of playing games again, it's been a little bit of a layoff for the team, as it always is around winter break. So did you feel your team was able to put that time to good use? And just overall, what did that time without a game look like for your group?
Well, a lot of good practice time that, you know, we need to clean some things up. A lot of good, every day in the gym, cleaning some things up, dealing with some nagging injuries that, you know, kids were playing through or just started that, you know, we're starting to get ourselves back to 100% healthy, you know, after, you know, 10 games, people's got, you know, ankles and knees and elbows and everything bumped and bruised, and it was good to just try to get us a little healthier here to start the new year.
And Coach, obviously this is a good time to look ahead to the matchup against Forest City, but that break is probably also a good time to kind of evaluate yourself in the first half and look at a few of the things that you guys did. So when you kind of do that self-evaluation for the first part of the season before winter break, what are a couple of your big takeaways from that early part of the season?
Well, you know, I think, you know, for an overall young team that we have, we've grown up fast. You know, I think our players have played some tough teams on the road and, you know, won in some tough environments. You know, winning at Western Christian was a tough environment to play in on a Saturday afternoon. Anytime you go to Armstrong, to North Union, that's a tough environment to play in. So I really thought, you know, our team grew up fast for being a lot of freshmen, sophomore that see a lot of minutes for us, that we grew up fast. I thought we competed tough. I thought, you know, we're finally getting to the point defensively, you know, closer to where we want to be. I didn't think starting the season we were as good defensively. I think we're crossing that barrier and really becoming a pretty good defensive team that is tough to score on.
Talking right now with Bishop Garrigan head coach Brandon Schwab. And coach, obviously not too hard to get excited for this one, because you have two teams that right now are undefeated in conference play and two teams that are ranked in the top 10 of their respective classes as you visit Forest City tonight. So looking at the Indians, what are a couple of the big things that stand out to you?
Well, they return everybody from last year. You know, I mean, they've got a really nice sophomore group as we do. And a lot of their players played a lot of varsity minutes last year. So, I mean, they're a very seasoned group that, that has just played a lot of varsity minutes. They're very talented. You know, they've got a very deep bench. They've got some really good guards and some complimented posts. They're very good. Since the Newell game, this is the second best team we've played, this year. They're very well rounded. They can shoot the three. They can go off the dribble. They can pound it in the post. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of matchups that causes some problems that we're going to have to be ready for. But they're just very balanced in their scoring. Hayden Brown is a phenomenal basketball player as a sophomore. You know, she's really leading the way for him and, getting better every time she comes out on the floor. So she is, she's a great basketball player, and they've got a lot of good guards with, Locus and Anderson and Jerome that go around her that they're just really handy. I really like their post player that comes off of the bench, the Jenna Donchi. She's really improving. She's got some good post moves. But, yeah, they cause us a lot of problems. There's just not one player you can guard. There's not one person or two people that we can focus on tonight that's going to completely shut them down. So we're going to have to be a balanced defense and really play team defense tonight.
And, Coach, looking a little bit at the other side of the ball, if you look up and down Forest City's schedule, they've had a few very impressive defensive performances so far and held a lot of teams underneath 40 points. So when you look at what Forest City tries to do defensively, what do you expect them to throw at you tonight?
Well, they're going to switch it up. They always switch it up on what they're going to do on defense. They're going to play a defense off of a make. They're going to play a different defense off of a miss. They're going to, try to keep you off balance with switching their defenses. And, you can get into that game with them of switching what you're doing all the time, or, you've got to get the correct spacing that we're not worried about switching what we're doing all the time. We can't get into that game because then our players get confused. We're switching things all the time. So, we've worked hard over break out of just, what they're going to do to us. With press and their half-court defense, they run, a matchup zone. They run man-to-man. They run a 1-3-1 that's run a little differently than other teams that we have seen. So, we tried to just come up with an offense that we're comfortable in that we can run against whatever they're in. Obviously we have zone and man stuff, but, I don't like to switch it up. It's like playing a Newell Fonda team. If you worry about trying to set it up and switch it up all the time down, you're just going to confuse your kids. So we're just trying to we worked hard on just, being able to get an offense that we can play against anything tonight because, I want us to play. I want us to play fast, and I want us to play our game. So I don't want us to be thinking about setting stuff up. I want to just play.
Coach, as you wrap up, what's going to be the final message to the team before tonight's game tips off?
It's a great – first way to start out of the new year. We need to control the boards. We have to get them go one and done and chase them off the three-point arc. If we can get them to go one and done and chase them off the three-point arc, I like our chances. If they're going to hit, if we allow them to get open threes, they're a good three-point shooting team, and allow them second chances, it'll be difficult for us tonight. So we're going to really key on trying to get them to go one and done and really limit their three-point shots. Our closeouts need to be good with high hands, and those are the two things we're going to really focus on.
Coach, thank you for the time today, and best of luck with tonight's game.
All right, thanks.
Bishop Garrigan girls basketball coach Brandon Schwab here on Hometown Radio KLGA. We'll step aside for a timeout and come back for more next on 92.7 and the Algona Radio YouTube stream.
At Security State Bank, we realize each customer has a unique set of needs and goals. That's why we place a greater value on providing outstanding customer service. All products and services are designed for customers within our local community. We value each customer that walks through our door and wants to give them the personalized attention they deserve. Find out why Security State Bank in Algona, Burt, and Laverne is your partner in community banking. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Security State Bank.
Getting set for girls high school basketball action right now on Hometown Radio KLGA as the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears visit the Forest City Indians. And right now we're joined by Forest City head coach Matt Erbeling. Coach, first of all, Happy New Year. How's it going today?
I'm doing good. Thanks, Tyler.
Well, Coach, let's start off with just winter break and how that went overall for your team, because obviously it's a couple weeks to get off from the games and really continue to work and get ready for the second part of the season. So did you feel your girls were able to put that winter break time to good use?
Yeah, definitely. We had a few minor injuries. We kind of need to get healed up, and several girls that were kind of had the flu bug a little bit there at the end of the pre-Christmas schedule. So break came at a good time health-wise, I guess, and, you know, with that dead period, it makes us get away from each other for a while and let everybody kind of recuperate and regroup. So good timing for us in terms of getting healthy, for sure.
Well, Coach, it was a great start to the season before winter break, as you guys currently are ranked in the top 10 of the Class 3A poll with a 10-0 record, and right now 6-0 in top of Iowa West play as well. What did you feel were a couple of keys to the good start to the season?
I think just, honestly, the mentality of the group I got this year, just extremely impressed with, you know, the opportunities in front of us. We had a lot of talent, a lot of depth, a lot of experience back, so, you know, we should have a successful season if we're locked in from the get-go. And as quickly as we've made that adjustment to just being mentally focused every night out, regardless of the opponent, regardless of the situation, and obviously, our depth, our versatility, 1 through 10 or 11, however many decide to play on a given night. But that versatility just makes us, you don't have to count on one person, always being on. If a girl has a bad night, we can go to option 3, 4, 5, or 6, whatever we need to pick up, the slack there a little bit. So that our versatility and our mindset are certainly probably our two strengths right now.
And, Coach, defensively, the team's played really well so far for the first 10 games as well. And defense is something that you can trust on a night-to-night basis, and it's something that travels as well. So when you look at what a good night defensively is for your team, what do you feel are a few pieces that go into that?
It's funny you say that, because I think you probably know me well enough that I kind of hang my hat on the defensive end, and, that's what wins tight ball games for you. But like you said, it travels. So if you go on the road and you're not shooting the ball well, your defense is going to keep you in the game. And my players really buy into the defensive end. Every kid I put out there loves to play defense, and that's usually not the case. They're not so worried about the offensive end. It's, let's try to get some defensive turnovers that lead to easy opportunities offensively. And, if we make it difficult for teams to score, we can afford to struggle a little bit on the offensive end. And I think the people that have watched us play, the first 10 games, quite often that's kind of the case. Might not get off to a good start defensively. Might take us, till the first quarter is complete, or, early part of the second quarter to finally find a defense that we like and that's working. And then we really lock down after that, and our defense kind of takes over, especially those middle two quarters. And then we kind of just are able to kind of just cruise home there in the fourth quarter. But one of our focus points, midway through our schedule there was, we hadn't been starting games very well defensively. We have started the last couple ball games, Clear Lake especially. We started the first quarter locked in defensively, and our offense took off. And so if we play 32 minutes of defense, we're really tough, I think, to compete with, really makes things difficult for our opponent. But if we take a quarter off or stretches of the game off defensively, good teams are going to take advantage of that and make it a ball game for 32 minutes.
Talking right now, Forest City head coach Matt Erbeling. And Coach, a fantastic matchup to start off coming out of winter break as you guys welcome Bishop Garrigan to your gymnasium. Obviously a little bit of a different Golden Bear team than the one you've seen the past couple of years, but certainly a tough opponent as well tonight. So when you look at this Golden Bear team, what are a couple of things that jump out to you?
Well, they're young, obviously, and extremely experienced, even though they are young. But, it's a different Bishop Garrigan team, obviously, but, the personnel are different, but what they do is the same. They still got the perimeter shooters. They got the Eastman girl inside that, is getting better daily, it looks like, with her fundamentals in the post. And so, they still do a good job getting the ball inside, with the lob passes that they've been doing to Audie for 4 years. So, it's like I said, it's pretty much the same system, just, a different person or two plugged in there. But, they got Capacious. So, I think she's kind of been the heart of that team, and hopefully, this year she gets a little bit of recognition for how good she's been. But she's just a hard-nosed competitor and, gets on the boards and does all the little things that, that kind of your casual fan maybe doesn't notice. But certainly coaches you know, on opposing teams know the value of her. So, you know, really, really solid team. You know, maybe not quite as deep as they've been in the past. You know, I think that might be one of the keys tonight is take advantage of our depth compared to the depth that Brandon has.
Well, Coach, you talked about taking advantage of the depth as one of the keys. What do you feel are the other keys to a big Forest City victory in tonight's game?
The number one key, and there's two that are right there, but probably the most important key is, you know, we can't let Bartolo and Elise get open threes. You know, I mean, they got range from 24 plus feet, you know, and they shoot it in rhythm. So we can't leave 3-point shooters uncovered. And I mentioned the job Abby does getting on the boards. We have to control the boards. We can't let, you know, Abby and Zoe does a tremendous job, and of course Eastman's on the boards pretty hard. So we got to keep them three off the offensive boards and limit them to, you know, one shot, and then get out and make them guard us on the other end. But certainly, you know, we can't give up threes tonight, plain and simple. You know, and we'll take our chances inside against the Eastman girl, but we can't allow their shooters to get going, because then they play with confidence, and then you're dealing with a nightmare in that situation.
Coach, we appreciate your time today and wish you best of luck with tonight's game.
Thanks, Tyler.
That is Forest City head coach Matt Erpelding with his pregame thoughts. We will step aside for a quick timeout on Hometown Radio KLGA and come back more next.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
American Glass. For all your glass needs, think American.
Farm Bureau Financial Agents Dave Beich, Jason Brace, Daniel Folk, and Michael Toth.
Kemco Tires, they're all you need to know about tires and service.
Weikert Realtors, the 515 agency, a fresh approach to real estate.
Billy Offerman, your State Farm insurance agent in Algona. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
BMC Advantage Insurance Services, insuring our neighbors for over 80 years.
Walker Chiropractic and Wellness, caring for Algona, Sway City, and the surrounding areas with chiropractic, nutritional, and physical therapy services.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
When you need cash on the go, there's no need to pay a surcharge fee with MoneyPass. Iowa State Bank is proud to be part of the MoneyPass network of surcharge-free ATMs found nationwide. Look for the green and blue MoneyPass symbol on over 32,000 ATMs across the nation. Or find an ATM near your vacation spot or travel destination at MoneyPass.com. MoneyPass, another way that Iowa State Bank helps people succeed. Member FDIC.
For over 40 years, Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons have maintained one mission: to provide excellence in orthopedic care. Their team of 9 physicians offer specialized care in everything from arthroscopic same-day surgery to joint replacement, as well as hand and foot surgery, and have an orthopedic surgeon on call 24/7. Healthcare isn't about appointments, it's about taking care of people, and that's their specialty. Visit Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons on the web at nwiabone.com.
It's time to meet the starting lineup for the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears.
Grayson Eastman, freshman, number 14.
Inside to Eastman. Eastman puts it up, and she puts it in.
Zoe Montag, junior, number 22.
Garrigan of a steal. Here comes the transition. A sidestep by Montag in the lay-in. Zoe Montag is going crazy right now, and Garrigan's up 81-38.
Tayshia Olish, sophomore, number 24.
Capacious hangs and passes to left wing. Olish three try, and she swished it again. Let Tayshia Olish shoot it.
Emmy Bartolo, sophomore, number 10.
Cross-court feed over to Bartolo. Catches, fires, rattles in a three-pointer.
Abby Capacious, senior, number 21.
A long pass inside to the cutting Capacious. Jumps, catches, finishes on the reverse. And we welcome you to Forest City, Iowa for Top of Iowa West basketball action. It's the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears and the Forest City Indians in a battle of two top 10 ranked teams. Forest City number 7 in Class 3A, Bishop Garrigan number 8 in Class 1A. Both teams 6-0 in the Top of Iowa West. For Forest City and head coach Matt Erpelding, their starting five consists of the junior Colette Logus, the senior Emma Anderson, the junior Bethany Warren, the senior Jaden Jerome, and the sophomore Hayden Brown. You've already heard Coach Schwab's lineup. As Bishop Garrigan is 9-1, they'll wear the road yellow uniforms, the black Garrigan across the front, front, the black stripes down the side, and the black numerals on the front and back. Forest City in the home whites, the red Forest City across the front, red numbers on the front and back of the jersey, and we are just about set to go. Beanie, what a matchup tonight. Bishop Garrigan and Forest City.
Yeah, second time Garrigan's got to play a bigger school that's ranked as well. Garrigan being ranked, and boy, all the marbles on the table since it's a two best teams clear in a horse race at the top of the conference.
The tap is won by Abby Capacious. She tips it to Eastman and gets it off to Montag as we are underway in Forest City, Iowa. Bishop Garrigan heads from left to right on the radio dial to start off quarter number one. Golden Bears scoring 65 points per game, number one in the top of Iowa West. Bartolo on the outside, heads across the foul line, dishes to the right wing to Montag. Montag flings it back to the top of the key to Capacious as she's guarded early by Emma Anderson. Now Allish for the basketball. Allish driving in, threads the pass to Eastman, way under the bucket, tries to fling it into the corner, but pass intercepted by Jerome.
Wait, right off the bat, you see the tenacious defense by Forest City, really chasing the Bears off the three-point line.
Forest City allowing just 33 points per game, the best defensive mark on the top of Iowa West. They're scoring 63.6, number two in the conference behind Garrigan as they almost throw it into the backcourt, but it's flagged down by the senior Anderson. Anderson had a career-high 15 points against Clear Lake right before winter break as the ball is down on the right corner of Jaden Jerome. Pass inside, knocked away by Eastman, and she has it for the turnover.
Defense by the Bears. Tyler, I think we're in for a defensive struggle tonight.
Both coaches love to emphasize that defense as Capacious has it along the perimeter, giving to Montag. Right side Bartolo fakes, drives in, flings it to Eastman. Eastman faces the bucket for a jumper. Too strong. Capacious rebound and a fresh 35 for Garrigan. Finds the cutting Montag off the window, and there's two.
Oh, what a find by Capacious off the rebound. She stuck with it. And Zoe Montag, Johnny in the spot, made that play with her head. Great cut.
Abby Capacious averaging 3 assists per game for Bishop Garrigan. As Golden Bears have 3 players in the top 6 in the top of Iowa West of assists per game. As Capacious has a steal and then throws it right back to Forest City as Warren peels it away. Warren gets it on the wing to Jerome. 3-point ball, in and out. Eastman, fingertip rebound in the paint. Eastman keeps the ball clean as she gets it away from Warren and finds Zoe Montag. 2-0 Bishop Garrigan. Handoff goes to Emmy Bartolo, the Golden Bears sophomore, averaging 11.3 points per game as she heads right. Bartolo on the blow-by, gets to the rack, and it's in and out, no good. It went halfway down. Rebound pops loose out to Capacious, gets it to Bartolo. Right wing three, and she drills it. What's better than a 2? A 3, Beanie.
Oh, wow, what a start. Both plays made by Capacious. They're keeping that rebound alive. Abby Capacious looking to have a big game for the Bears tonight. Coach Erbling for Forest City knows how dangerous and tenacious she is.
3-point ball for City off the back of the cup. Rebound to the near side to Eastman. Eastman trying to rip it away, and we've got a jump ball. Getting tied up with Jaden Jerome was Eastman.
Yeah, Tyler, that 3-pointer was huge because that one is nothing that the Forest City defense could do about because that was off a rebound. Bartolo was over there on the 3-point line. Capacious found her, and nothing that Forest City D could do.
Inbound pass stolen away by Eastman. She's forced a couple turnovers tonight as Garrigan has the basketball out of the turnover. Bartolo into the front court. Squares up for a 3-point shot, and it pops off no good. Capacious offensive board, takes one dribble, puts it up, and that one's no good too as Forest City dodges 2 bullets. Warren outlet pass to Hayden Brown. Brown behind Allish. Brown off the window, and there's 2 for Forest City.
Opportunistic fast break there by Forest City. Looked like it was going to be a sure thing after another good rebound by Capacious.
Into the lane, knocked away. It's stolen by Anderson. Running the floor, it's 2-on-2. Anderson stomps at the top of the key, finds the trailing Locust on the left wing. Rainbow arcing free, she swishes it. We are tied at 5.
Well, that was a heck of a pace turnaround, and Forest City can put up points in a hurry as well. Boy, Tyler, both these teams shooting the 3 right out of the gate.
Colette Locust is a 31% 3-point shooter. Forest City, 33.1%. Number one on the top of Iowa West on 3 balls is Bartolo. Heads right across the foul line, fakes one way, pivots the other. Trying to stay in front is Anderson. Bartolo, tough shot, no good. Capacious, another cleanup, and Capacious sets it in for 2.
Wow, I got to start keeping track of this. I believe that's 4 rebounds by Capacious, and 3 of them have resulted in buckets for the Bears, one by herself right there.
Abby Capacious, number 2 in the conference in rebounds per game, 9.6, already well on her way. 4:27 on the clock, 7-5, Bishop Garrigan. Ball on the right side to Emma Anderson. Comes up top to Logus. Logus, the junior guarded by Bartolo. Inside, the entry pass knocked away from Warren. Ball gets rotated into the right corner to Jerome. Pass inside to Brown. Knocked out by Allish with 17 on the shot clock.
Well, what a treat here, Tyler. These teams are both extremely athletic. Very fast-paced basketball for girls' high school.
Very fast-paced so far as Logus has it up top. Rotates it around to Anderson. Now down low. Warren, shot blocked by Eastman. She erased it in the paint. Montag has the basketball now. Brings it across the FC logo at midcourt. Montag drives in, dumps it off to Eastman, wide open for two.
What a drive by Montag. She's a lefty. She goes hard with her left hand, knows that she's got Gracelyn Eastman once she gets inside.
9-5 in favor of Bishop Garrigan at the 350 mark. Logos sidesteps to a three, and she swishes again. Colette Logos for her second tray of the night.
Wow, Colette Logos can shoot. They aren't even touching the rim. She's swishing them.
Colette Logos averaging 10.9 points per game, shooting 31% on three balls so far this season as she's knocked down two early ones. Bartolo waits for the offense to set up for Bishop Garrigan at the 3.5 minute mark. Capacious tops out, finds Montag underneath. Montag for two.
That's a nice four high set there by Bishop Garrigan. Nice set play. Patience in setting it up, and they got the easy bucket.
Well, sometimes you can fall asleep on Montag thinking she's just going to shoot the three, but got to open up the nice pass by Capacious as it's 11-8, Bishop Garrigan, and we have a traveling violation called against Forest City.
You know, Coach Schwab mentioned in his interview they worked a lot on an offense. They can run against both a man and a zone. That little four-high set is one of those offenses. You can work a lot of plays off that four-high set regardless of the defense in there, and that was great execution by the Bears. Boy, that's what you get after a long winter break of a lot of practices.
Capacious right of the paint, has the ball peeled away and it's stolen. Here comes Forest City off the Logos steal. Jenna Donchi is checked in for the Indians in place of Jaden Jerome. Into the corner, Anderson free ball, rolls off the cup. The box out by Hayden Brown. The nice bounce pass to Donchi. Can't finish it though as Capacious hugs the rebound in the paint.
That was a rare second chance point the Indians have gotten so far today, but not to get a third one as Capacious gets her fifth board.
Montag crossover dribble, wings it out to Bartolo. Deep triple on the way, off the heel, no good. Eastman tracks down the rebound for Bishop Garrigan. Now Aulish steps back for a three-point ball. A little bit too strong, and Logos rebounds in the paint. Logos gets it into the front court. Logos wants to take it coast to coast. Quickly gets it out to Warren. Mid-range jumper left short. Ball pops loose in the lane. Picked up by Anderson. Gets it outside. Three-point ball again for City. Hayden Brown leaves it short. Warren on the offensive board. Her layup misses. Ball gets tipped at the Brown. Fourth opportunity for Forest City. Right angle three-point ball. Logos. That one's no good. Rebound Donchi. Fifth opportunity and it's in.
Wow. Five shots on goal. That has got to make Coach Erberling really happy about his offensive rebound. And Coach Schwab furious that his Bears didn't get that defensive board, but they all just bounced right away from the Bears. That's the way the ball bounces sometimes.
Both coaches heavily emphasized rebounding and one and done for the opponent in the pregame interview. Bishop Garrigan 11, 4, City 10, 1:46 on the clock, quarter number one. Aulish near side, driving in, bouncing it to Eastman. Crowd wanted to travel. Eastman shot, rejected by Donchi. Here comes Emma Anderson. Anderson averaging 8.9 points per game, has the rock across half court. Anderson driving against Aulish. Eastman helps, and we have a foul against Bishop Garrigan. First foul of the game.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, Tyler. We've got a minute and 31 left to go in the first period, and there hasn't been one foul, but it's not because the refs haven't been looking. These teams are just playing extremely clean defense, good positions down under the basket, and a nice crisp basketball coming out of this break.
Lexi Eisbrand in for Forest City. Reagan Murphy in for Bishop Garrigan right now as Eastman heads to the pine. Brown, far side of the court, rises for a three-point ball. She swishes it. Indians have the lead, 13-11.
Well, and they are hot from the three-point line, swishing.
Hayden Brown leading the conference in three-point percentage this year as Bartolo takes a wide angle to the bucket. Shot no good, and the rebound is taken by Eisenbrand. Into the front court, finds Brown on the left wing with 1:08 on the clock in quarter number one. Anderson up top, backs up to the edge of the Forest City logo as we tick down to the one-minute mark. Brown off an early 5 points for Forest City. Eisenbrand gets to the foul line. Gets it outside, three-point ball on the way. Donchi clangs off to the right, no good, and Murphy vacuums in the rebound.
I don't know that Donchi usually takes those.
Bishop Garrigan has the basketball right now. Donchi was 0-1 on three-pointers so far this season, so that was just her second attempt. Aulish on the left wing, three-point attempt blocked by Warren. Ball gets batted out to Aulish, keeps it alive to Montag. Montag, center of the paint, flips it out to Abby Capacious. Capacious in the lane, rises up, and rolls the shot in.
Yeah, Capacious had the three-point shot, but she passed it in knowing she'd get a better look inside. Good decision.
Quick outlet for City, banging her way inside is Warren, and she'll draw the blocking foul by Reagan Murphy, Bishop Garrigan seconds.
Boy, Forest City can get the ball up the court very quickly. Garrigan, other than Newell Fonda, has not seen a team that can move the ball up the floor that fast with their guards. Very athletic Forest City team. You know, Tyler, Donchi doesn't usually take a lot of threes, but if they're falling like they are for Forest City, I'd chuck one up.
What we saw last year, Beanie, Four City had Bethany Warren. It really doesn't take a lot of threes, and she took them a lot against Garrigan because Audie Crooks was clogging the lane, and Warren, of course, knocked down a few of those three-pointers last year as the foul shot is good, and Four City goes up 14-13, splitting the pair.
Another substitute comes in the game for Four City, and Gracelyn Eastman will come in for Garrigan shortly.
22 seconds left in the first quarter as the ball taken by Emmy Bartolo across half court. Bartolo will dribble away most of the time here at the end of the quarter. Four City off the bench has Brennan Giesen coming into the game. That was the sub. With 8 seconds left, it's Capacious. Hands it off to Alish with 6 seconds. Alish with five. Hands it back to Capacious with four. Garrigan's got to hurry here, and they get bailed out by a foul. 2.1 seconds left, but not a lot of time to operate.
Yeah, that foul might actually end up being an opportunistic foul there for Four City as 2.1 seconds. Tough to get a good shot off here. Capacious is going to take it out of bounds. And she's got a good mismatch inside. If they can get the ball to Eastman, Eastman's got a good position inside, and Capacious is going for it.
Lob into Eastman, knocked away from her in the paint, though. 2 seconds, 1 second, half-court heave is short at the buzzer, and that is the end of quarter number one. It's Four City 14, Bishop Garrigan 13 as we head to the second on KLGA 92.7 and at the Algona Radio YouTube stream.
We've got more sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Reeves Wicked Good Bar and Grill. For wicked good food, drinks, and service, you gotta go to Reeves.
CB Grain Solutions, satisfaction guaranteed.
New Way K&H Co-op, delivering exceptional value through knowledge and innovation.
Dump It, they do the dirty work so you don't have to.
Albert Electric, flip the switch to Albert Electric.
Grassmasters, growing satisfied customers.
Greg Penning and Company, certified public accountants, where everyone counts.
Yemlin Builders and Apartments, quality apartments for rent, beauty and craftsmanship that will never go out of style.
Daylight Donuts, open early with delicious donuts and great coffee.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
Never know that both these teams took 2 weeks off from games. This is the first one coming out of winter break. The pace has been high early. The energy's been up there. And right now it's Four City leading Bishop Garrigan 14-13 in the start of the second quarter. Garrigan has the basketball with Abby Capacious. Top of the key now to Eastman. Goes right side to Bartolo in front of the Four City bench. Cuts across the lane, finds Capacious just to the left of center. Now it's Alish. Curls her way in, kicks it to Montag in the right corner. Montag with plenty of time to work with. Montag enters the paint, heading left. They will wave it off as there is a foul before the shot. First on Four City of the quarter.
Going to call that blocking foul. Garrigan kind of went to a dribble drive offense there, just kind of egg-beatering that ball between each other. One after another, each guard is driving, and that creates a lot of blocking fouls. That time picked up on number zero, not technically a number, is it, Tyler? But there's a zero out there.
Yeah, that's Giesen for Four City as Eastman powers it inside and scores. Garrigan back in the lead by one.
Good decision by Garrigan. Isolate Eastman. She had a mismatch down there, got her the ball. Easy deuce.
15-14, Bishop Garrigan. Four City has been largely built on defenses. They've held a lot of their opponents to 35 points or less. In fact, 8 of their 10 so far have been held to 35 or less. And meanwhile, they've scored at least 55 every game as they try a backdoor cut by Anderson. They get it back into the lane. It's hooked up, and the shot is just off target to the left by Isebrand, and Bartolo has the basketball for Garrigan. Bartolo quickly outlets it up to Alish. Alish drives in towards the bucket. Alish gets the shot rejected by Donchi. She swallows it up. Four City will run. Here comes Brown taking long strides to the bucket, and she puts it in for two.
Emmy Bartolo tried her best, but didn't have the height there to block the shot. She tried to run interference, but was not successful. Good bucket for the Indians.
16-15, Four City. Bartolo drives in the other way, and she got to the cup for two for Garrigan.
Oh, returns the favor there. Nice drive by Bartolo. Trading buckets here in the beginning of the second.
Yeah, Bartolo takes a lot of threes, but she's got a quick first step as well to really get to the cup. Pivoting inside and putting it off the window for a nice two is Donchi as she spun towards her right.
Yeah, Donchi and Eastman are about mirror images of each other physique-wise. There's going to be a tough battle in there.
Well, we've seen three lead changes here to start off the second quarter, possession after possession. Both teams going blow for blow here, executing good offense early on in the quarter. Capacious pops out to get the ball, gets the screen from Montag as she heads right. Deals the ball out to Alish on the right side. Alish guarded by Brown along the perimeter. Alish Heads left around the three-point line as she hands it off to Bartolo. Takes a couple dribbles towards the right as she has 10 on the shot clock. Finds Capacious. Capacious top of the key. Across the foul line. Now Montag. Left corner triple. Line drives it short. Rebound picked up by Hayden Brown for Forest City.
That was a good box out by the Indians. They had all the Bears covered there after that Montag three went awry.
Brown, number four on the top of Iowa West in points per game at 14.6. Gets it away as the shot clangs off the glass by Emma Anderson. Capacious tiptoes the baseline and throws it away. Bartolo was talking to the bench, and that was who the pass was intended for as Forest City has the possession.
Yeah, Capacious, she was losing her balance as she got that rebound. She was falling out of balance. She just tried to throw it to the outlet.
Long entry pass into the lane off the fingertips of Eastman out of bounds as Eastman was grappling with Donchie once again underneath.
Well, both teams slowed down a little bit offensively, but as Coach Erbeling said, he doesn't worry about his team not scoring offensively because they can produce so many points off their defense. But Garrigan does not give up a lot of turnovers as they have excellent ball handlers. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out.
Bishop Garrigan has subbed Alyssa Hoagland into the ballgame for the first time tonight. Forest City with the ball right now. Eyes of Brand, far side of the court. Gets to the foul line. Elbow jumper. Brown misses left. Capacious grabs the rebound. She tumbles to the floor. And that is a traveling violation against the Golden Bears senior.
She skied for the rebound, but as she came down, her legs locked up with other people. Lucky we didn't see any ankles get blown there. Capacious is going to stop and retie that shoe. She might be thinking the same thing. She better tighten up this ankle lace a little bit. I'm going to start coming down on people, but Capacious is really rebounding well. I got her at 7 rebounds already, Tyler, on the night. If that one counts before the travel, correct?
Yes, it counts before the travel. So Capacious gets the double knot set, and Forest City has the basketball following the travel. A nice pass inside to Warren, and Warren draws the foul. That was a beautiful find by Isaac Brand to the cutting Warren, and Garrigan picks that one up there first of the quarter.
It's a good attempt by Gracelyn Eastman to block that one. She went for the big swat, just caught enough of the hand to get called for the foul. And they'll line up for free throws here. 18-17, Indians on top.
As the free throw is good, and now it's 19-17. Isaac Brand had been 2 of 4 at the foul line coming into tonight.
You know, I'll tell you what's a real treat here watching these two teams, Tyler, is you can just see the competitiveness of all 10 girls on the floor, no matter who they are, just the will to win by these young women out there. You don't always see that every single game, but, boy, they are really competitive, and that is fun for the coaches to coach as well.
Three throw good, and it's 20-17 for City.
As Logos just kind of tried to steal that inbounds pass, and she ends up knocking it out of bounds. Fortunately, she can get called for the foul. Logos, bloody nose, she's been out of the game for a while, treating that bloody nose. She's back in there now, and that's big because she has the hot hand.
Yeah, has some gauze up in there to prevent the bleeding as well as we return to action of 4:53 on the clock. Olish, top of the key, sidesteps into a three-point ball. She banks it in to tie the game. Timeout by Coach Schwabish. Sasha Olish hits a big three-pointer.
Speaking of competitiveness, Sasha Olish, you never have to ask her who wants to win because she just goes and goes and goes. And you could see she was locked in. She was going to score whether she had to drive or shoot the three. She ends up getting the bank three. I don't think she intended that, Tyler, but she'll take it.
She will take it. Well, we've seen just about everything so far early in this game. Forest City actually came out kind of beating Garrigan at their own game early on, hitting a lot of those threes, really playing a fast pace, the things that Garrigan likes to do. Then we saw a point in time in the second quarter. Things kind of slowed down a bit, but I think maybe Coach Schwab is talking about that a bit right now. Things kind of getting a little stagnant on offense. Obviously, you like the banked in three, but you can't count on the bank every single time.
You know, both these teams are going to have plenty of blowouts this year against inferior opponents, but man, these coaches are both working as hard as they can. Both coaches employing their players on their respective benches of what to do next. Coach Erbeling's got an interesting approach. He talks to all the assistant coaches. They all have a little huddle between the coaches. Then he goes after and passes word to the players. Coach Schwab gets right in there. He bounces things off Bartolo and Mick Albert as he talks, but he certainly has a plan too. And they use every second of that timeout as the refs break up the huddles and say, time to play ball.
Well, that'll be the first timeout taken by Iowa's side. Relatively few fouls so far. Relatively few timeouts taken. As Forest City will have the basketball coming out of the timeout. Tied up at 20. Coach Erbeling looking sharp as always. Beanie rocking that suit jacket. Were you a suit guy when you coached?
I didn't own any suits when I coached. I had to make some money first.
No surprise there. As Logos has it near side of the court with 4:38 on the clock. Up to the top, ball is fumbled a little bit by Isaac Brand, but she's able to bounce it back to the left wing to Logos. Flings it across to Jane Jerome, guarded on the corner by Capacious. Back to the left wing to Warren. Warren into the paint, attacks into Eastman, and the layup no good. Eastman stayed vertical that time as Warren tracks down the loose basketball for Forest City. Now it's Isaac Brand in traffic. Pass got kicked out of bounds. Kick ball against Garrigan.
You know, Eastman was right there for the rebound, but didn't want to risk another foul. You know, there's no foul trouble on either team right now, but you get that first foul call down, it changes the way you play sometimes. For a second, until you got to focus in and don't change your game.
Four City gets the basketball inbounded. They get it into the center of the lane to Warren, as she'll kick it back to the outside to Logos. Cross-court feed over to Jerome. Works the baseline, getting it into the paint to Donchie. Spins into the center of the lane and sets it in. Nice move and soft touch by Donchie.
Nice move indeed. That was a great spin move. Tyler, we love the spin move. Boys, girls, basketball, that always seems to work, that spin move to the hoop.
It is so effective. If there was a fifth man of the year in the top of Iowa West, Donchie might be it. 7.9 points per game off the bench as Eastman powers inside and draws the foul, going right back at Donchie for Four City's second foul of the quarter.
That ball almost dropped through the hoop, and that would have been a big and-one situation for Eastman there. We're going to be back and forth here. Right now, Four City's on top 22-20.
So Eastman setting up for two free throws. A really good free throw shooter so far as she's shooting 71% and knocking down the first one. Hayden Brown checking back in. Emma Anderson for Forest City is heading to the bench. Donchie as well as Isa Brand.
Typically, you shoot good free throws like that means you spend a lot of time in the gym. And, you know, I do pop into school every day, feed the fish, water the plants, and there was a lot of cars in the Garrigan parking lot over break. Lots of practice happening.
Second free throw no good, but Capacious for eighth rebound. Gets it out to Hoagland. Her three-point ball is too long. Montag tracks it down, throws it into play, but it's intercepted by Logos. Logos out to Brown. Brown down the lane. Gets by Hoagland and lays it in.
With her left hand, crossed over, made it with her left, kept the defense away from her.
24-21 in favor of Four City as Bishop Garrigan finds themselves back down by three. Bartolo working near the Four City logo as we're under 3.5 minutes to go until halftime. Capacious collects the basketball left wing, nearing double-digit rebounds already. Bullet inside to Eastman. Power dribble, draws the foul again. This time Bethany Warren the guilty party as Eastman is starting to go to work.
Good find by Capacious. She had it at the top of the key and just ripped a bullet pass right down the middle of the lane to Eastman. Good connection between those two.
So Eastman back to the free throw line, averaging over 15 points per game so far as she is the number three scorer on the top of Iowa West. Her first free throw good to cut it to two as Alsh is back in and Hoagland is heading to the bench for Garrigan.
That's a good break for Alsh on the bench. Good minutes from Hoagland there.
Eastman will settle for a split as that one's no good. Warren grabs the rebound for Four City. Down on the left corner, it's Jerome. Catch and fire three-pointer. Pops out, no good. Went halfway down as the ball is knocked out of bounds. Last touched by Hayden Brown for the Indians.
You know, that's a good rest for Alsh because she's the player that's going to carry you down the stretch ball handling. As the defense turns up, the pressure, you got to have your energy. And Bartolo's been handling a lot of the ball handling.
Bartolo has it right now just inside of half court as we tick under the three-minute mark in quarter number two. Forest City 24, Bishop Garrigan 22. Bartolo inside to Eastman, deep in the post, backing in against Warren. Fades back, and she puts it in. Eastman ties the game at 24.
She did a great job of sticking that pivot foot onto the hardwood, not traveling, and really did a nice job maintaining her balance.
Bishop Garrigan playing a 2-3 zone defensively right now as Warren has it on the left baseline. Threads the pass to the cutting Anderson. Anderson shot in the paint, no good, and Eastman secures the rebound. Tied at 24 with 2:28 left in the first half. Capacious brings it into the front court. Bishop Garrigan has won their last eight matchups against Forest City. Golden Bears' last loss in this series was February 4th of 2019 as they lost 53-49 in that one. Driving in Alsh, blew a tire, but that's because she was fouled. Number four of the quarter against Forest City.
Yeah, you can see that freshness off the bench. She was going to get that all the way to the hoop. And Garrigan will have it underneath to execute an inbounds play. They're going to go four low across the bottom.
That was the second personal foul on Hayden Brown. Inbound pass swatted out of bounds by Brown. She sent it right back into Alsh. And Garrigan will try again as Isa Brand returns to the ballgame for the Indians. And Brown heads to the pine.
Now Garrigan has definitely focused on getting that ball in this second period to Gracelyn Eastman. And she's been answering the bell here. She's looking to get the ball right here off the pass from Capacious.
This time Capacious inbounding as they switch out. They find Montag in the left corner. Up to the top to Bartolo. Looks inside for Capacious. A Forest City player falls down. Outside Eastman. Two of her foot on the line. And it's no good, but Capacious yet another offensive rebound. 2 minutes left in the quarter. Capacious looking for Alsh. And Alsh has the basketball near the center of the court as she heads right. Hands it off to Zoe Montag. Montag head fakes and she travels.
Oh, she was going to drive hard to the lane with that left hand. And she got so excited. She took a little quick step. Got a call for the travel. Tied here at 24, minute 54 left to go until halftime. Four City with the ball. And Logos with a hot hand is going to be guarded tight at the top of the key.
Anderson gets it into Warren. The Four City junior takes one dribble and flings it outside to Isa Brand. Isa Brand flustered by the defense as she bounces it into the right corner to Warren. Now foul line Jerome. Quick pass down low looking for Anderson. Knocked away by Garrigan and Montag has it with 1:37 on the clock. She'll give it off to Bartolo, and now Bartolo finds Alsh deep on the left wing. Picked up by Isa Brandish. She'll come up top to Bartolo. Inside to Eastman, trying to shield off Warren. Eastman peels the ball away from her and puts it in for two.
Oh, good hands by Eastman. It was very nearly a steal by Forest City. But Eastman just had that glue on her fingers.
10 points by Eastman, 26-24 Garrigan. Warren driving it against Eastman, threads the pass to the cutting Anderson, kicks it out right wing Jerome, and she'll pass up the three-point ball with 109 on the clock. Now Warren in the right corner. Warren driving in, also with a poke away. Ball loose on the floor. Bartolo picks it up, and it's a jump ball.
While Garrigan is playing their 2-3 defense, they're very good at that. They've got the most experience, I feel, in the 2-3 over the years, and they are very comfortable in that defense. Forest City, little bit out of sorts, trying to break into that 2-3.
From the baseline, Anderson pumps. Anderson looks, and she'll get it into Jerome. Jumper from just outside the paint, no good. Rebound by Eastman. She'll throw it to Logos, but it goes through her hands and finds Montag. Garrigan narrowly avoids a turnover as we have 54 seconds left in the first half. Bartolo brings it up top, 26-24, Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears 9-1, Indians 10-0 so far this season. Rainbow pass into Eastman, catches and finishes again. 12 points so far by Eastman.
What a lob by Capacious, a rainbow indeed.
Now can Forest City answer. In the lane, Warren takes one dribble. She's in a sandwich, and her pass goes away to Capacious. Addie Capacious has it poked away by Isa Brand, and it rolls right to Anderson for Forest City as the Indians force the turnover, and now the shot clock is off. Near half court, Anderson will dribble and burn clock as Aulish creeps up to defend. Anderson unloads the ball left and finds Logos with 16 seconds left on the game clock. Bishop Garrigan up by four. Logos heads right around the perimeter and bounces to Isa Brand of 10 seconds. Against Aulish, tries to poke it away. Pass goes right corner to Anderson. In the lane, Anderson, wild shot left hand, and she draws the foul. Right before the end of the quarter, of 4.7 seconds left, and Anderson is going to shoot two.
Well, she very nearly got the roll on that. She did a little scoop layup with her left hand. Tough degree of difficulty on that shot. She almost got to fall. Now she'll shoot free throws.
Foul number two on Eastman as the free throw is no good. Anderson's 72.7% from the free throw line. That scoop layup came from a fair distance away from the basket. That was about an 8-footer there. 4.7 seconds left. Free throw no good, and Capacious has the rebound. Capacious with three. Quick outlet intercepted by Logos at half court. Logos heaves it at the buzzer and missed it left. No good. That is the end of the first half, and a very eventful half at that. Bishop Garrigan 28, Forest City 24 as we head to the half on KLGA 92.7 and at the Algona Radio YouTube stream.
Thank you to these sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Kossuth Regional Health Center, make KRHC your home for health care.
Tom Eichen Sales, your store in the country, carrying steel and Toro products and Green Mountain pellet grills.
Algona Plumbing and Heating, where a good flush always beats a full house.
Runke Brothers Full Service. Experience the Runke Brothers difference for all your auto service and repair needs.
Erpelding Boyd & Company CPAs, they're not just about taxes.
Hy-Vee, use the Fuel Saver card. Fill your cart, fuel your car.
North Iowa Appliance Center, Highway 18 East in Algona, where they sell the best and service the rest.
Erpelding Excavating Enterprises, let them take care of your grading, excavating, and drainage needs.
AK's Chrome Kitchen. When you come in, your family.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
At Security State Bank, we focus on the needs of local families, businesses, and farmers. Decisions are made locally. We live and work in your neighborhood, helping to keep our local community vibrant and growing. We're involved in local community events. We believe in personalized service and advice that meets or exceeds your expectations. We're Security State Bank in Algona, Burt, and Laverne. Bankers who believe in you. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. Security State Bank.
Halftime in Forest City, Iowa right now as the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears lead the Forest City Indians 28-24. Before we give you the stats from the girls' game, we're going to talk boys' basketball. Bishop Garrigan coach Mark Meister. Coach, happy new year and thanks for joining today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
You know, Coach, obviously a couple of weeks off here from games, so, you know, a chance to get some practices in and work on a few things from the first half. How did you feel your team use that time from, you know, the winter break effectively?
I thought really well. We brought two teams in and had a scrimmage, put in some new plays, got to run them, a few new defenses, so got rid of some old stuff we were running, cleaned up some stuff we had been running. So far I thought, you know, over break it's gone really well. Now tonight it's going to matter. Are we going to come out with pace or have that winter hangover from all that food that we ate? But we'll see how the game starts and we'll know in the first few minutes.
Well, Coach, when you have a chance to kind of look back at the first 10 games of the season before winter break, how do you evaluate where the team started versus where they are now?
You know, the goal, the dream goal was obviously 8-2 or undefeated, but, 6-4, we had a hell of a schedule to start the season. I thought it was a tough amount of games we had to play against some teams that had been to state, runner-up in 2A in Hall and Algona 3A that went to state, and obviously Lake Mills had been to state. So where we were at coming in, after that football, we were a little bit behind. I thought we kind of started a little shaky with our pace, not running our stuff as clean as we'd like. We're not where we want to be still, but we're trending in that right direction. Tonight's a big game for us. These next 2 weeks are huge for us with the conference standings. It's a big one we need tonight.
Yeah, and like you said, Coach, that top of Iowa Conference is really clustered up at the top right now. If you look at the loss column, there's three teams with just one loss. You guys are just one game behind of two losses, and, Four City is one of those teams right at the top. So tonight, obviously, a game that matters quite a bit. When you look at Four City and maybe some of the improvements they've made since last year, what stands out to you?
I think all the guards have gotten a lot better. They're kind of sharing the ball and scoring evenly, and they run their stuff really well. So they're not just isolating somebody, so it's defensively we're going to have to communicate a lot and make sure kind of those wrinkles we've put in with help side and weak side defense that we match those things so we have guys in the right spot to kind of shut off some drives and some open shots. They have a few guys that like to do a runner pull-up shot that's really hard to defend, so we kind of put some things in that hopefully we can get to them early and they're not getting a steady dose of making those.
Coach, as we wrap up here, what do you feel the biggest key for a Garrigan victory tonight is?
We got to come out with energy and pace and then be able to mix and match defense as much as possible. What we've seen on film, teams that have kind of done that, they have struggled with that. The more comfortable they get, it sounds silly, but it is, the better they play, and it seems like they get comfortable easy. So look for a lot of different defenses, and hopefully with what they run against us, what we've practiced, we'll be able to implement offensively tonight.
Well, Coach, thank you for stopping by, and best of luck with tonight's game.
All right, thanks for having me.
That's Bishop Garrigan boys basketball coach Mark Meisters. We'll step aside for a timeout and give you some halftime stats coming up next on 92.7 KLGA.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
American Glass. For all your glass needs, think American.
Farm Bureau financial agents Dave Beich, Jason Brace, Daniel Folk, and Michael Toth.
Kemco Tires, they're all you need to know about tires and service.
Weikert Realtors, the 515 agency, a fresh approach to real estate.
Billy Offerman, your State Farm insurance agent in Algona. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
BMC Advantage Insurance Services, insuring our neighbors for over 80 years.
Walker Chiropractic and Wellness, caring for Algona, Sway City, and the surrounding areas with chiropractic, nutritional, and physical therapy services.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
When you need cash on the go, there's no need to pay a surcharge fee with MoneyPass. Iowa State Bank is proud to be part of the MoneyPass network of surcharge-free ATMs found nationwide. Look for the green and blue MoneyPass symbol on over 32,000 ATMs across the nation. Or find an ATM near your vacation spot or travel destination at MoneyPass.com. MoneyPass, another way that Iowa State Bank helps people succeed. Member FDIC.
Big thank you to Bishop Garrigan boys basketball coach Mark Meister for stopping by and sharing some of his thoughts before the Golden Bears play Forest City coming up. But first, still 16 minutes of basketball left in the girls' matchup as Bishop Garrigan leads Forest City 28-24 in this game between two teams that are currently 6-0 in top of Iowa West play. Forest City grabbed the lead after one. They led 14-13 at the end of the first quarter, but Bishop Garrigan outscored the Indians 15-10 during that second stanza to take this four-point halftime lead. Gracelyn Eastman leading the way with 12 points for the Golden Bears. She's the leading scorer overall. Meanwhile, Hayden Brown has 9 for Forest City. I'm Tyler Lance. My partner's Beanie Bodie. Beanie, interesting first half we've had so far.
Yeah, boy, that first quarter, Forest City was shooting lights out from the three-point line. They were just letting it rain, got out to that lead. Then in the second quarter, you could just feel a big shift when Garrigan switched their 2-3 defense, and they started to lock down that perimeter a little better. Bartolo and Alish at the top of that 2-3 were denying any easy three-point looks, and it's tough to go inside against Capacious and Eastman. They play good defense, and Forest City, they executed their offense pretty well. They got some good looks, but, as the old cliche goes, their shots just weren't falling. Meanwhile, Garrigan made a concerted effort to go inside to Eastman in that second quarter, and she was great.
Well, and you bring up a good point, Beanie, about Bishop Garrigan switching to the 2-3 defense because they started playing man-to-man, but watching a lot of Coach Erpeling teams over the years, his teams always seem to be really good about picking apart man-to-man defenses and finding the matchup they want. So Coach Schwab called the timeout. Garrigan made the adjustment, and Forest City has slowed down offensively since that time. Now, if you're Coach Erpeling and the Indians, how do you try to attack that Garrigan 2-3 zone in the second half?
Well, Erp has all kinds of ways to attack those 2-3s, and he was getting that little soft middle of the lane shot pretty well. They were looking to pass that interior pass down low to the baseline cutter. Like, they're getting shots, but Garrigan has run that 2-3 a lot. They're very good at closing out and reacting to that. You know, both these teams are just very good defensively. You're not going to get an easy shot. You're always going to have a hand in your face, and that's why it's 28-24. Both these teams probably scoring 40 in the first half on a lot of their games, but good defensive matchup so far. You know, Garrigan has just made some dynamite passes inside of Eastman. Coach Erpeling said in his interview, you know, he's going to take his chance with Eastman because he doesn't not want to get Garrigan hot from the outside with all those three-point shooters that Garrigan has, and they've done a really good job with that, don't you think, Tyler?
They have knocked down some three-point shots, and they have a lot more three-point shooting and more experience than they've had in the past couple of seasons. And meanwhile, both coaches also talked about rebounding in their pregame interviews. They said, limit second chance opportunities. Garrigan did have one defensive possession where they gave up five opportunities and Forest City finally scored the fifth one. But besides that, they've rebounded very well. Unofficially, Beanie, you and I have Abby Capacious for 9 rebounds. A lot of those on the offensive side. So Garrigan, they've created a few more second chance opportunities on the glass than Forest City has.
Yeah, she's so tough on the boards. It's almost like you want to pick one girl on your defense and say, anytime a ball goes into the air, someone find Capacious and get a body in front of her, because if she's anywhere close, she's going to get it. She also gets a lot of rebounds just by being in the right spot at the right time. She's played so much basketball. She knows where the most likely place to be, where that long three-point shot, where it's going to clang off the rim and come to. She gets herself in the right area and gets it. She also has done a great job of getting assists off that rebound. She's grabbed a couple rebounds offensively and looked right back inside and created assists to a cutting Montag at the beginning and then to Eastman. And that's been big for the Bears. But both coaches knew that rebounding was going to be a premium coming into this game. And Donche for Forest City has been a bright spot inside. As you said, Tyler, yeah, she might be the off-the-bench player in the conference because she is tough inside. And I bet she was really challenged at halftime to really lock Eastman down. So that's going to be an interesting matchup the rest of this game as well.
Yes, now both teams will bring their starting five back onto the floor, but if I'm Forest City, I'm probably not leaving Donche on the bench for too long to start the second half, because like you said, Beanie, she was really holding her ground against Eastman on the defensive side, and offensively, she had some really good moves that can make it tough for Bishop Garrigan to defend. In fact, Donche, so far this season, scoring just under 8 points per game on just about 48% shooting, so that's good to have coming off the bench. As you said, both teams bring their starting five back in, but I expect to see Donche very soon.
This is an exciting game. I think both teams and both coaches are saying, hey, we got them right where we want them. So we'll see how this plays out.
Start of the second half, Garrigan gets a quick touch inside on the block to Capacious, kicks out to Bartolo, corner pocket three, and she hits it.
Wow, what a start. Bartolo just ice in her veins, doesn't hesitate, pulls the trigger right off the bat.
Emmy Bartolo, 40.5% on three-point ball so far this season. Down to the baseline, it's Brown, shields off Eastman and sets it in.
So that's some excellent execution by Forest City. Perfect play against that 2-3. Eastman did not want to foul, lets her have the basket.
11 points by Brown, 8 points by Bartolo for Garrigan as it's 31-26 in favor of Bishop Garrigan starting off this third quarter. Garrigan heading left to right on the radio dial. Eastman catches inside, got past Warren, and she spun the layup in.
What a pass. You know, all those years passing to Audie Crooks, the Bears have thrown that lob pass so well, and it's just continuing here with Eastman.
Yeah, Warren was trying to front Eastman that time, and it seems like an easier matchup, but Garrigan, like you said, so precise with those passes that it makes it almost impossible for the post defender as a left side three-pointer by Locus rims out, and in the lane, it's Eastman fighting for the rebound.
And we'll see how Forest City defends a lob this time, because Garrigan will just keep going to it until they can stop it.
Bartolo handles the rock near side of the court as she finds Olish down to our left. Back up to the top of the key to Bartolo. Gets the screen from Capacious. Gets a foul line extended jumper, and she airballs it as it's picked up by Jerome off the floor.
And good answer by Forest City. They had someone in front and behind Eastman that time. Because, Tyler, Garrigan throws passes when they don't even look like they're open.
Turnaround jumper from just inside the foul line. No good by Anderson. Offensive board for Brown. She's among the trees, and she bounces it out to Warren. Warren, jumper, bounces off. No good, and Eastman grabs the rebound. A couple mid-range shots. No good for the Indians.
Great offensive rebound there by the Indians, but they could not convert it to points there.
Well, back to that last point, Beanie. Bishop Garrigan used to, we'll throw the ball inside, and Audie's going to catch it no matter where it is. And I think some of those habits have held over for Eastman, and they've worked extremely well. As Aulish is left of the paint, Aulish prancing in, scoops the layup up and in.
Well, now that Garrigan offense is gaining momentum. Unless that Forest City defense can really crank it up here, this 9-point lead by Garrigan is going to extend real quick.
35-26, largest lead of the game by Bishop Garrigan. Brown, a short corner jumper, air ball into the pocket of Zoe Montag. Dribbles away from two Forest City white jerseys, and Montag brings it across half court. Montag stops for a three-point ball in transition, left it short. Ball deflects toward the far side. Aulish tries to tap it back into play, but it stays out of bounds and goes back to the Indians.
That's a good stand there by Forest City. Forced a long shot. Garrigan misses it. Now they have a chance to cut into the lead. But, boy, Tyler, that three-pointer by Bartolo to start off the half really kicked off a good run here by the Bears.
And a timeout by Coach Erbeling and the Forest City Indians with 5:30 on the clock. We'll take that timeout as well, a 60-second timeout on KLGA 92.7 and at the Algona Radio YouTube stream.
We've got more sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Reeves Wicked Good Bar and Grill. For wicked good food, drinks, and service, you got to go to Reeves.
CB Grain Solutions. Satisfaction guaranteed.
New Way K&H Co-op, delivering exceptional value through knowledge and innovation.
Dump it. They do the dirty work so you don't have to.
Elbert Electric. Flip the switch to Elbert Electric.
Grassmasters, growing satisfied customers.
Greg Penning and Company, certified public accountants, where everyone counts.
Yemlin Builders and Apartments, quality apartments for rent, beauty and craftsmanship that will never go out of style.
Daylight Donuts, open early with delicious donuts and great coffee.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
Bishop Garrigan is trying to slowly pull away from Forest City. The Golden Bears lead by 9. Forest City has the basketball coming out of the Coach Erbeling timeout. Right corner three-point ball, Anderson left short. Brown rebounds in the lane. Actually make that Donchi, and Donchi draws the foul. Fresh off the bench, Jenna Donchi gets a big offensive board, and she'll head to the charity stripe for 2.
Yeah, first thing they did during the timeout, they decided to get Donchi back in the game, and she makes her presence felt by a big offensive rebound there. Boy, they kicked it out to that three-pointer, Tyler. It was a good look, and they missed it. You know, Forest City down 8 points now as Donchi hits the first of her free throws. You know, they're going to have to shoot their way back in, which is a tough thing to do when you don't hang your hat on offense. You hang it on defense. Well, maybe their defense can create some steals.
And the free throw is up and good. Speaking of steals, Forest City number one in the conference with 16.3 steals per game as they show some pressure on Bartolo in the backcourt. She tries to dribble away from Logos, and she brings it across the half-court line. Her handoff to Capacious goes awry, and now here comes Forest City at the steal. Top of the key, it's Logos. Waits for everyone to catch up, and she'll bring it back to half-court as Forest City gets a big steal right there against Garrigan. 35-28, it's a 7-point game as Bishop Garrigan leads the 5-minute mark of the third quarter. Left corner to Anderson, in the lane, Donchi pivots right, shot rolls off, no good. Ripped away on the offensive board by Brown, and a foul on Abby Capacious.
That was a big battle by Capacious. She could have been a jump ball there. Both players kind of had it for a moment. Good battle underneath. Garrigan sets some of their 2-3. Boy, Bartolo had just doing such a nice job handling the ball, but you feel Forest City is going to ratchet up their press here.
35-28, Bishop Garrigan. Indians have won the last 10 games inside of this gymnasium dating back to last season, and they've won their first 10 games in a row to start this year. Into the post, knocked away from Donchi, Easton with the quick hands, ball rolls to the perimeter, picked up by Bartolo, gets it out to Aulish. Aulish across half court, Aulish looking to drive. Aulish kicks it out to Bartolo, 3-point ball on the way, and she rattles it in.
Wow.
Big shot, Emmy Bartolo.
No kidding, not only was it a big shot, she made that shot for herself because that was an incredible hustle play by her on defense. She dove for the loose ball.
Three-point ball, Brown too strong, and Capacious out-battles Donchi for the rebound.
Well,
and she pushes away from Donchi as the crowd wanted an offensive foul.
Yeah, she pushed off big time. She's not going to have any of that in her face. Boy, Bartolo and Capacious really just taking the game over here. And now Donchi gets called for a foul for reaching over the top of Gracelyn Eastman.
That'll be foul number 2 against Donchi because a lot just happened there in a short period of time. Foul number 1 on Forest City of the quarter. But that is a momentum-building sequence by Bishop Garrigan as they lead by 10.
Huge. To get that 50-50 ball because Emmy Bartolo dove for it, and then she gets the 3 at the other end. What a huge turnaround. Garrigan up 10.
Top of the key, Eastman hands it off to Bartolo. Fakes on the 3, drives, and she carried. That'll be a turnover.
Well, they'll keep going right back to Bartolo. She is feeling it. Her and Aulish up top in this 2-3 are also creating a nightmare scenario for Forest City to get easy three-point looks at the top of the key. Eastman's going to get a break. Reagan Murphy into the game.
So Murphy will play in the center of that 2-3 zone that's worked effectively for Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears 38, Indians 28. Golden Bears have outscored Forest City 10-4 to start the third quarter. Isabrand in the high post coming off the bench. Flings it into the left corner to Brown. One dribble sets herself for a three-point ball. The rainbow arcing three is too strong. And Capacious with yet another rebound keeps it away from traffic. Abby Capacious unofficially in double-digit rebounding already for Bishop Garrigan as Bartolo dives down the lane, kicks it to Murphy. Long two for foot on the line, left a little bit short, and Brown skies for the rebound over Montag. Brown outlet down to four to Isabrand. Isabrand lets Capacious fly by. Her layup is no good, and Murphy has the rebound. Murphy trying to rip it away, and a foul on Forest City.
Big board by Murphy there. Miss by Forest City. Boy, that one was one they kind of had to get there. Great outlet pass. They got the ball right underneath the rack. Couldn't put it in for two. 10-point lead continues. 3.5 minutes left to go in the third. Capacious is going to inbound to Bartolo, who's been slicing and dicing up the floor.
Ball almost got knocked away by Logos, but Bartolo keeps it safe as that last foul was number one against Emma Anderson, who's been held off the scoreboard so far for Forest City after scoring 15 against Clear Lake. A nice pass inside to Murphy. Wide open, and she lays it in.
Oh, nice job. Sasha Alish lulled them to sleep. She took on two players, and no one had Murphy underneath. Great eyes by Alish.
Sasha Alish, 3.6 assists per game, and passes like that are exactly why. Up at the top, Isabrand driving in, scoops the layup up, missed it. Rebound volleyball out to Capacious, who grabs the rebound. Capacious brings it across half court. Almost got too casual there as Logos nearly stole it away, and Coach Schwamm takes a timeout. Logos was in Capacious's blind spot that time as Schwamm takes the timeout with 2:51 on the clock and a 40-28 lead by Bishop Garrigan. Boy, this game has turned around really maybe not 360 because Garrigan was battling early against Forest City, but the Golden Bears have really taken over since that early Garrigan timeout.
Yeah, they were down by four early, and this third quarter has just been all Garrigan. Forest City getting to the hoop, but just not getting the buckets to fall. But Garrigan is just tearing it up down there on the offensive end, driving to the hoop, finding open shooters, ripping down rebounds. Boy, it all started with Bartolo in that corner three-pointer, started off the third quarter, and then she kind of sealed it there with that steal that converted into a three-pointer by her. This quarter has been dynamite by Bartolo.
40-28 in favor of Bishop Garrigan of 2:51 on the clock. We'll see what Garrigan does coming out of the timeout as Eastman back in for Murphy. Coach Schwamm really has a great feel of when to call timeouts and really a great feel of when to switch between zone defense and man-to-man defense. And we talked about that early switch tonight to the 2-3 zone as Capacious has the ball for Garrigan, handing it off to Bartolo with 2:47 on the clock. Bartolo dribbles up near the top of the key as she'll fling it to Capacious on the left wing. Facing the bucket of 2:40 on the clock, guarded by Anderson. Capacious takes one dribble and passes it out to Bartolo. Rises for a three-point ball, rolls off no good, and Brown snatches away another rebound. Brown up to Isabrand, takes one dribble, lays it up. Layup is short, and the rebound is taken by Alish. Alish weaves into the front court. Alish driving in. Alish with a sidestep, the scoop layup and the spin in. Alish with great English on that ball, makes it 42-28.
Wow, coast to coast by Alish, gets the roll. Unbelievable.
Sasha Alish is taking about 73% of her shots from three-point range, but she's gotten a couple nice drives tonight as Isabrand will make that daunt. She got fouled, and I think she got poked in the eye. Eastman will pick up her third of the night.
She'll go to the free throw line, shoot two. You know, Tyler, Forest City's just got to be pulling their hair out down there. They've had a couple fast breaks, look like they're going to be easy buckets, and then they don't make the layup. And meanwhile, Garrigan has Alish go down there and does some crazy shooting and gets it to go through the hoop. Like, It's sometimes that's the way the game goes, as Eastman's going to come out with those three fouls. Murphy back in, and she just got a bucket a moment ago.
Forest City's probably left 6, maybe even 8 points on the board here in this third quarter by just not being able to knock down those point-blank shots in transition. Both foul shots good for Donchie, and it's 42-30, Bishop Garrigan. Largest lead was 14 for the Golden Bears as Alyssa Hoagland has the basketball right now, also coming in place of Zoe Montag, as we have 2 minutes left. Quarter number three in this big top of Iowa West matchup. Two teams that are 6-0 in conference plays. The Golden Bears have their 62-game win streak on the line. Alish tried to pursue a ball that was going near the boundary and touched it as it was heading out.
Yeah, Forest City player got a handle on that. You know, Coach Schwab's got Hoagland in there. He's got ball handlers in. Alish, Hoagland, and Bartolo all can handle the ball really, really well, as he knows Forest City definitely turned up the pressure here, as they did there, created a turnover.
Anderson gets it into the high post to Isebrand. Takes one dribble and picks it up. Comes back to Anderson on the right wing. Anderson to the foul line, back to the bucket. Shovels it out to Logos. Logos finding Brown just to the right of center. Brown tries to find the cutting Isebrand. Passes a little bit out of her reach and out of bounds along the baseline.
Boy, I don't know how she got that pass through that hole. That was an eye through an eye of a needle. She somehow got that ball in there. It was such a good pass. I don't think Isebrand thought it was going to make it all the way through. Wasn't ready to catch it.
1:33 left in the third quarter. Bishop Garrigan has the rock right now of Emmy Bartolo. The Golden Bears sophomore gives it off to Olish on the left wing. Top of the key to Reagan Murphy, now rotates it to the right wing to Hoagland. Flips it into Capacious, knocked away from behind by Warren. Hoagland has it back. Hoagland, near side to Olish. Olish weaves into the paint, kicks it out to Bartolo, but it's way over her head and out of bounds as Olish took a little contact while she was passing.
Yeah, there's an unforced error. I'll drive Coach Schwab crazy. He's got this 12-point lead. He just wants them to run some time here, use up that shot clock. He's got those ball handlers in there, but they turned it over there. Here come the Indians.
Montag will replace Olish for Bishop Garrigan with 1:10 left on the clock. Quarter number three, 12-point advantage by Bishop Garrigan. Giesen flips it away. It was off the fingertips of Warren. It went to Logos. Back to Warren. Her foul line jumper no good. Rebound is tipped away. And Donchie tries to tap it back in. Was she out of bounds? Yes, she was.
She stepped on the line as she was tapping it. Well, I'll tell you, just think, after starting the game hitting three-point shots against the Garrigan defense, Forest City has hardly been able to get off a lot of open threes. Garrigan really changed up their pressure on that three-point line. Then again, Coach Erbelin is also pushing that inside game.
Bartolo wants to drive inside, sidesteps Donchie, draws the foul, puts it in. Chance for a three-point play by Emmy Bartolo. All of the basketballs are dropping in on that side of the court for Garrigan.
They are. Bartolo and Olish, they chuck anything up there, and it seems to be going in. But this quarter has been all Emmy Bartolo offensively. She is really putting up some points here, stretching out this Garrigan lead to 14.
And Bartolo drills the foul shot. Bartolo has 14 points, and now it's a 15-point lead at 45-30. Capacious checks out. Reese Kemna coming into the game for the Golden Bears with 48 seconds left in the quarter. And now Forest City trying to get something going before the end of the quarter, but Garrigan with their largest lead of the night so far. Giesen drives in, flips up a tough shot. It's no good. It pinballs out, and it's taken by Kemna. Kemna across half court, waits, and gives it to Montag. 5-second difference between game clock and shot clock right now as the game clock is down to 30 seconds, shot clock at 25, and Bartolo comes to get the basketball up at the Forest City logo. Bartolo heads to the left, hand off to Montag. Montag trying to keep it away from trouble, and it's knocked away. Logos had the steal, got it to Giesen, back to Logos along the baseline, and Logos stepped out. Forest City couldn't convert on the 2-on-1, but now they say Garrigan touched it last.
Yeah, it was Montag got, I guess Logos was inbounds, threw it to Montag, and she had a sliver of that shoe on the line. And Forest City have a chance to cut into this lead. 17 seconds left.
Ball is lobbed into Donchie on the left wing. Pass to the top of the key, jumped by Hoagland. Hoagland, one-on-one of Logos. Across the lane, left the basketball behind, though. It's loose on the floor for 9 seconds. And we have a jump ball of 8.9 on the clock.
Nice play by Hoagland. Golden opportunity for Forest City. You get a bucket there. And Hoagland jumps the pass, takes it the other way. Just been the all Golden Bears in this third quarter.
8.9 seconds left. Kemna will guard in the backcourt against Isebrand. And inbounding it will be Logos down to our left. 8.9 seconds. It rolls out to Anderson. Anderson across half court of 7. Flips it near side to Isebrand of 6. Rotates around. Anderson of 3 seconds. Lets it rip. 3-point ball. A little bit too short. No good. The cleanup by Donchie. And the layup is in and out at the end of the quarter. Boy, that quarter was all Garrigan. And that final play really summed it all up as the layup is no good. We head to the fourth. Bishop Garrigan 45 and Forest City 30 on KLGA 92.7 and at the Elgota Radio YouTube live stream.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
Farmer State Bank is proud to be part of our community. Offices in Algona, Whittemore, and West Bend.
Stroman Dental, giving you something to smile about.
Bill's Auto and Truck Repair. Service is the difference.
Friends Salon, your complete family hair salon. It's all about you.
Oakcrest Funeral Services, celebrating a life lived.
Algona Frame and Auto Body, we meet by accident.
Water Connection, from softeners to bottled water and service, call 295-SOFT.
Algona Pizza Ranch, there's so much to love.
Cotton Grave Farm Management and Land Realty in downtown Algona, trusted for farmland service needs since 1960.
Sponsoring this broadcast on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Bishop Garrigan has the basketball to start the fourth quarter. It's knocked away, and Forest City has the steal. Brown will run the floor. Brown left of the paint. Brown stumbles a little bit, and she traveled. That third quarter was all Bishop Garrigan as the Golden Bears had a 17-6 scoring advantage. They lead it right now, 45-30.
Well, not surprisingly, Forest City comes out, gets a good steal, and rushed into the basket. She traveled as Garrigan has played really good defense, hustling back, and really making it difficult for Forest City to get anything going.
Forest City has won 10 games in a row to start the year. It's only the second time in program history they've won 10 in a row in the 5-on-5 era as Garrigan travels and turns it over. The other time was in the 2003-2004 season, but they lost game number 11 of that 10-game winning streak to Garner, so a win tonight would set a program record, but they will need a big comeback here in the fourth to get it done. They have the rock right now. Brown, far side of the court, beyond the perimeter. Quick bullet pass down to the baseline, secured by Warren. Warren, a 3 points so far tonight. Into the lane, big collision and a blocking foul against Abby Capacious. Heading to the line is going to be Locust for Forest City.
Yep, going to the line.
Or check that Brown.
Or Brown going to the line, but that's why it's been so difficult against Garrigan. They're just not letting those slashers get all the way to the basket. You get the feeling that buckets that Forest City has gotten to drop fairly easily just aren't dropping tonight. They're not getting those looks. And, you know, that's a testament to the Garrigan defense. Like, both these teams play really hard defense, don't give you anything easy.
So Brown, 53.7% from the foul line. As first one, no good, 7:28 left in quarter number four. But Indians just 6 points during that third quarter as Brown tees it up. And she'll swish the second one to split the pair and make it 45-31. Bartolo with a little pressure in the backcourt. Passes near side to Capacious, but it's knocked away by Anderson and throws it right back to Capacious. Boy, the crowd is looking for momentum, and now Locust steals it from behind and takes it away from Capacious. You've got to check the rearview mirror if you're Garrigan, as Forest City is going to hunt out those steals aggressively for the rest of the game. Down to our right, Warren feeds Daunchy in the post. Bounce pass peeled away by Montag out of bounds. Did not let that ball get into Brown.
No, looking for some good interior passing there were the Indians, but Montag guarded that baseline well, swatted that ball away.
Anderson to set things in motion from the baseline. Lobs it into play to Logos. Down to our right in front of the Forest City bench. Right corner Anderson guarded by Capacious. Wings it across the Brown. Quickly picked up by the Garrigan defense as 1 minute is gone here in quarter number four. Right wing three-pointer Logos. And it's an air ball heading out of bounds. And it will go back to Garrigan as Warren couldn't save it.
And Logos is one player they're going to need to heat up if they're going to shoot their way back into this. But misses there. And the pressure continues. Eilish with the ball.
Well, Locus hit those two early three-pointers in the first quarter, but she has not scored since then. She's been stuck at 6 points as the Bishop Garrigan defense has closed off a three-point ball. 45-31 Bishop Garrigan here in Forest City, Iowa. Golden Bears have won 8 straight against the Indians, including 95-49 and 84-50 last season. Both those wins were 40-plus point games by Audie Crooks, who had 45 and 42. The flip into Eastman goes off the glass, no good. Ball out to Eilish, her three-point ball. Rims out, no good, tipped away, and Capacious gets yet another offensive rebound. Quick entry pass to Eastman against Donji. Wraps the pass in the corner to Bartolo. Catch and fire, threes and air ball. Eastman had it for a moment. It's out of bounds, last touched by Donji for the Indians.
Wow, got a lot of looks by Garrigan there. 3 offensive rebounds in a row.
And they will have an opportunity here of 27 on the shot clock. Hard to believe the shot clock is still only at 27 if all that just happened. Eilish gets it into Montag, wide open in the lane. Shot blocked by Warren on the recovery. That looked wide open for Montag for a minute there, but Forest City gets the ball back. Over to the left wing, Anderson. Anderson drives, splits two defenders. Her floater is short. Eastman picks the ball up before Anderson can track it down. Quick outlet to Bartolo. Bartolo right of the lane. Bartolo drives in, sidesteps Brown. Layup no good as Brown stayed in front and didn't foul. Logos comes out with the basketball. Logos with pace. Stomps for a foul line jumper. Banks off to the right, no good. Rebound loose. Eilish grabs it. And it's knocked away. Also trying to get it to Capacious and knocked out of bounds by Warren.
Wow, what a pace here in this fourth quarter as the Indians try to fight their way back into this game, but nothing doing. They've only had 1 point on the board. They just can't get anything to fall. Got to be approaching one of their season-low shooting percentages, I'm sure. And Garrigan is doing a fantastic job maintaining control of that ball as Coach Schwab wants to call a timeout, talk it over.
Coach Schwab calling a timeout, and
Four City's played 10 games so far this season, and they've scored at least 55 points in every game, so they are well below that pace so far. And we say it all the time with Garrigan, you know, the offense is what grabs people's attention, you know, whether it's a team last year, the year before, even this year's team, but that defense is really kind of what this team is built around. They've taken some good scores this season and taken them out of contention, and even a well-balanced team like Four City, Garrigan's found a way to defend against them.
Yeah, it's exciting to watch the defense when these teams are so crisp and clean. I mean, look at that, the fouls. There's only been one foul in this half. We're in the fourth quarter. But it's just a lot of clean play. They're everywhere. They're quick. Both teams full of athleticism. They're just up and down the floor in a heartbeat. We've seen some good, clean blocks. Just a treat to watch these good defensive teams play. But if you're Forest City, the defense has been good. You're holding Garrigan to 45 here in the fourth quarter, but do you have the offensive firepower to get back in this game? And that is going to be tough because they've been ice cold since the halftime break. And part of that, Tyler, might be that pressure. You know, they went into halftime down four. You've got that monkey on your back, and sometimes you play a little tense, and the shots just aren't falling for you. And Garrigan is quite used to stretching out leads.
Well, this is a Forest City team that offensively really ripped apart Clear Lake in that game before Christmas break. They hung over 70 points on the Clear Lake Lions, a team that had won the North Central Conference a couple years in a row and got a big win right before break. But you wonder, too, coming out of break, how the teams will shoot, how they'll react as the ball is raked out of bounds with a foul by Donchie. Knocked it out with the left hand, but fouled Eastman with the right hand, and that's number one against Forest City.
You know, Donchie's just going to get better and better here for the Indians. You can see her game is pretty solid. Her and Eastman are a great matchup against each other.
Eastman of 14 points, Bartolo of 14 for Bishop Garrigan. Donchie has 10 for Forest City as Capacious catches just inside the three-point line. Kicks it out to Bartolo. High arcing three-point ball off the back of the cup, no good. And the rebound is tracked down by Aulish. Aulish gives it off to Bartolo as Garrigan has a fresh 35. Golden Bears are taking over 24 three-point attempts per game, most in the top of Iowa West, as the pass is stolen away by Warren. Warren driving to the bucket. Warren, layup no good, didn't take a good angle that time. Her pass to the foul line knocked away by Eastman and taken by Capacious.
Well, that's just a perfect example of the way this game has gone. They play great defense. Warren gets a steal, misses the layup with a bad angle, and right back to the Bears.
Left angle free, Zoe Montag. She missed it left, and the rebound is secured by Donchie. Over 3 minutes are gone on the fourth quarter, and both teams have yet to hit a field goal. As Warren goes inside, she got fouled, and she put it in. That will change that, as Bethany Warren has a chance for a three-point play. She got hit by Abby Capacious, who came in with too much momentum.
I can see how Forest City can put up a lot of points because they are so adept at getting that ball up the floor in a hurry. Boy, that ball went up to Warren, and she was to the basket in a heartbeat. It's one of the few times Garrigan has been able to get back on defense, but if you get against a lesser opponent that doesn't have your athleticism, boy, I bet Forest City's fun to watch.
And an airballed free throw will go back to Bishop Garrigan at 4:43 on the clock. Bethany Warren was the Forest City leading scorer in both matches between these teams last year of 17 and 12 points, respectively. As Aulish catches the inbounds pass, tries to evade traffic in the backcourt, sprints it across the half-court line towards the left corner, and finds the trailing Capacious with 4:35 on the clock. Capacious with 4 points tonight. Double-digit rebounds for Bishop Garrigan as right now the Golden Bears senior has it and finds Eastman top of the key. Rotates it around to Alyssa Hoagland, finds Capacious curling towards the lane. Capacious swarms in the paint, kicks it out to Aulish. Deep three-pointer off the back of the cup, and the rebound is boxed out by Anderson.
Well, Garrigan was able to use a lot of clock there.
Anderson collects her pass at the court, almost stolen by Capacious. Off her hands, though, and out of bounds as Forest City keeps it.
Coming up on 4 minutes left in the game, Garrigan up 12 points. You know, you just got to think if they can just take care of the ball the rest of the way and use up that shot clock, they're going to be okay. Easier said than done.
Forest City will put some pressure on defensively for sure as Isebrand weaves into the lane. Her bounce pass to Donchie rolls away, and nobody touched it. It's out of bounds off of Forest City.
Yeah, they pass up some open shots. They just need shots right now. Regardless of where they come from, but now they get their press set up.
4:06 on the clock. Bartolo's in the corner, gets it away to Capacious, and finds Aulish far side of the court. Golden Bears will break the press. Aulish weaves into the front court with 3:59 on the clock and finds Bartolo. Takes one dribble and gets it out to Capacious. Golden Bears will execute methodical offense down the stretch here in quarter number four, trying to hand Forest City their first top of Iowa West loss and give themselves their 63rd straight top of Iowa West win. Bartolo finds Eastman in the post. Eastman trying to reverse, kicks it out to Aulish, catch and fire free pointer, and it's off the front of the rim. Brown sails in for the rebound for Forest City.
Derek can keep going for that dagger three-pointer.
Brown across the logo finds Warren and a blocking foul against Abby Capacious, her fourth personal foul and foul number three against Garrigan.
She tried to get there and get set, Referee disagrees. Forest City, a good opportunity to score here. You know, Tyler, how much do you think that Newell Fonda game, where Garrigan had that relentless Newell Fonda pressure in him, is helping him out in this situation against Forest City? I mean, if I feel like quite a bit.
I was going to say, I think it's helped immensely because I thought in that game, Garrigan did a pretty good job of breaking Newell Fonda's press. But you mentally prepare for that press, you physically prepare, you prepare the execution and the kind of plays you want to run against it. And those principles still stay the same when you're facing Forest City, even if the press looks a little bit different and the athletes look a little bit different. So I think it helped a lot, and that'll definitely help Garrigan down the stretch of the season, too, to face that kind of competition early. Forest City for the basketball right now. Logis finds Warren on the right wing. Warren drives in. Foul line jumper no good as she line-drived it. Offensive rebound, though, secured by Anderson. Gets it to Warren. Barrels her way inside and sets it in for two. Down to a 10-point game.
Boy, Warren is just either hot or cold. She had a really ice-cold shot, didn't even draw iron, then finishes up with a really hard make right there.
We're under the three-minute mark, and Garrigan has yet to score in the fourth quarter as the ball is stolen by Forest City. Here comes Logis. Logis to the bucket. Layup no good. Brown on the cleanup, and Brown puts it in. Single-digit game. Don't fall asleep yet, folks. Coach Erpeling calls a 30-second timeout for Forest City, and this game is not over. Bishop Garrigan has not scored yet in the fourth quarter, and Forest City is back into this 45-37.
Wow, what a comeback by Forest City. And like we thought they might be able to do with some defensive steals, Garrigan had a chance to ice the game with a couple three-point daggers. They just didn't fall after starting off that. I guess it's a teeter-totter of a game. Third quarter all Garrigan, fourth quarter all Forest City.
Well, and the thing, too, is Forest City missed a few opportunities early in the quarter. I mean, with the way Garrigan has started offensively, they're fortunate this game isn't close or even tied at this point because the Indians certainly started this quarter slow on the offensive side.
Yeah, that's true. And, you know, time is becoming a factor here. 2 minutes, 47 seconds. Garrigan has got this lead here, but I guess you got 35 seconds of shot clock. If you do the math on that, if you can work that whole shot clock, but Forest City is not going to let you.
Montag to inbound from the baseline, wings it into Alyssa Hoagland with 2:46 on the clock, and they'll try to pin Hoagland in the backcourt. Sidelines it to Montag, and Garrigan gets it across half court as Montag keeps the pivot foot. Now they'll sandwich Montag. Montag in trouble on a timeout by Coach Schwab. Bishop Garrigan will have one timeout left as Coach Schwab did not like what he saw there.
Well, he wants to get Capacious right back in there immediately, even with four fouls. He wants her in that game. So he calls timeout, gets her back in the game. Hoagland did a great job ball handling. She's been in there. Anytime you need a ball handler, you can bring Alyssa Hoagland in the game. Excellent ball handler there for the Bears. And ball handling is a premium. But, Tyler, going back to that, you know, you can't simulate that intense pressure in practice. You can try, but those are the girls that you know and your teammates that you play with. They're not going to be as bloodthirsty as these opponents, like Newell Fonda earlier this season, like Forest City tonight. You know, that's a whole new thing. Crazy stuff can happen when that pressure gets ratcheted up.
And you can just feel it, too. After the last couple of points, the crowd is starting to perk up a little bit in the background. The players are starting to perk up a little bit on the Forest City side. The crowd effectively felt this game was over, but all of a sudden, they feel like their Indians are back into it, and for good reason. 45-37 in favor of Bishop Garrigan. 2.5 minutes left. Golden Bears have the rock right now. Sasha Allish. Allish of 7 points tonight as she heads right around the perimeter. Hands it off to Bartolo, far side of the court. Bartolo into Eastman. Back to the bucket. Buries the shoulder. Layup no good. She was too strong. And a fight for the rebound and a foul on Garrigan. Logis secured it, and Montag is the guilty party for Garrigan's fourth foul.
Logis had good inside position there, but Montag was not going to be denied. She's fighting for that ball all the way. Gets called for the foul. That does give Garrigan a chance to get back, set up their 2-3 defense, and Forest City has been scoring in transition, so that's not all bad.
So Forest City will have to find a way to score against the 2-3s. Anderson dribbles on the left wing, passes across the way to Brown. Brown, top of the key to Logis, with 2:07 on the clock. Logis whips it right as she finds Isa Brand of 2:04 on the clock. In the center of the paint, Anderson, 10-foot jumper is up and good.
Oh, good execution against the 2-3 defense, finding that soft spot right in the middle of the lane. They've been missing that shot, but she nails it there.
45-39, 9 straight points to start the quarter by Forest City. Garrigan still yet to score on the fourth as they're down to the 1:45 mark. Now the crowd is definitely back into it. Montag near half court. She's pinned in a double team, but a foul. I don't think Forest City wanted to foul there, but they did.
No, they didn't. They were just trying to tie it up. Referee Berkey over there right on the spot. Sees contact, calls the foul.
Foul number two against Anderson as Coach Schwab or make that coach Erpeling will take the timeout. Forest City will have two left, and it comes at the 141 mark. So things are getting a little intense here. If you're Garrigan, you're at the point now where obviously you want to run clock, but you might need a bucket before it gets too late, because Forest City, they're getting back into this at this point, down only by seven.
Yeah, they are.
Down by six, excuse me.
Coach Erpeling using these 30 seconds timeouts. I think he wants to talk to his team, but he doesn't want them to lose momentum necessarily. Meanwhile, Coach Schwab, he's calling plays down there in his huddle. You know, he's got his ball handlers in there. He knows they're going to be aggressive. They're used to this. Both coaches have to watch their timeouts now. Garrigan has one timeout left. Forest City has two. And those can be extremely important here with a minute 41 left in the game.
So Bishop Garrigan will have the basketball for a big possession. It is a two-possession game right now. You'd feel a lot better if it was three. Bartolo gets across half court, fighting with Isebrand. Behind the back dribble, she heads towards the left, drifting towards the near side of the court. 1:30 left in the clock. Bartolo running all around the court. Pass inside to Eastman. Eastman catches. Eastman with the finish. The ball tried to sneak out, but it went down.
What a pass by Bartolo after getting narrowly avoided in a closely guarded call. Oh, and here's a turnover. Oh, right back to Forest City.
The ball went right to Eastman, but then went right to Warren after Eastman. Ball inside to Isebrand, no good. Rebound is knocked down onto the floor, picked up by Isebrand. Inside Warren, her shot bothered. Pops back into the hands of Isebrand. She's pinned under the bucket. Her bounce pass out to Brown with 1:02 on the clock. Now Forest City has to hurry. Near side Locus, catch and rip three. Too strong. And Eastman, contested rebound in the paint.
Good now, look by Forest City. Big rebound by Eastman.
Full court press. Players bumping into each other for Garrigan. Alsh got hit in the eye by Bartolo's shoulder. Garrigan gets it across half court, but Capacious is inside of a double team. Finds Bartolo open in the corner, but she passes up the three as they'll burn time instead. Bartolo now drives in, and a double dribble. Oh, she was wide open twice. Wanted to burn clock, but she hesitated, and that caused the double dribble.
Yeah, she thought, geez, maybe I should just make this layup. They're going to give it to me. And then she touched it with both her hands. Bartolo's been dynamite handling the ball tonight against tough pressure. Now Forest City's really up against the wall.
36 seconds left, and a 47-39 lead by Garrigan. Left wing three-point ball, Brown, and she rattles it in. Exactly what Forest City needed, and it's 47-42. Another timeout call by Forest City. They will have one left, and we have 29 seconds left in this ball game. Forest City has done everything they can to make this one interesting down the stretch, Beanie.
This is tough. 30 seconds left to go in the game. 5-point lead. You got to have someone hit the three. And, man, was that Anderson that hit that one just there?
Brown.
Brown hit that three-pointer. Do you go to her again? Garrigan's going to be all over that three-point line because, you know, Garrigan also has that ability to score. They've been going. They went to Eastman inside pretty easily. They're probably going to come right back to that play right here, force Forest City to foul. Or, Tyler, do you run clock and get to the free throw line?
Boy, a lot of great questions to be asked of Coach Schwab. Sean Clark's going to be off at this point. I think he probably forced Forest City to foul you, especially Garrigan's a really good foul shooting team. Down the stretch, you trust your players to make free throws. So first priority, I should say, is keep the ball safe, keep it in your possession. But I think he tried to force a foul by the Indians and see if he can burn 5-10 seconds off the clock with that.
I think so. This is also that, I totally agree, but this is also that situation where Forest City is going to go so hard defending this inbounds pass that Capacious is going to make. They might get something easy over the top, get a layup here.
So 47-42, Garrigan on top, 29 seconds into rolling, and they will foul Bartolo immediately in the backcourt. That is team foul three against Forest City as they have a couple to give.
Yeah, good setup by Garrigan. They got all their players at half court so they can all sprint to the ball, namely Bartolo with her great speed, catch the ball, get fouled immediately.
Capacious is the inbounder. And Bartolo catches near the baseline. Bartolo far side of the court, weaves in between a double team, and they try to steal the ball, and they reach in and foul Bartolo. That burned 3 seconds off as we're down to 24, and that's foul number four against Forest City.
It's a good job by Bartolo. She caught that on the far side, slalomed between a couple players that were both taking pretty good swipes at the ball, and still managed to get over to the near side.
So inbound play coming this time from the sideline by Capacious. She's right in front of the scorer's table on the right side, just off the edge of the Forest City bench. They haven't even given Capacious the ball yet, and players are trying to get open already. This is intense, of 24 seconds left. Capacious is the inbounder, guarded by Warren. Gets it into the front court to Montag. Montag catches, and she stumbled, and that's a travel.
Wow, tough break for the Bears. Montag skied to go up and catch that ball. Must have shuffled the feet when she came down. And the Forest City crowd and team are excited, telling themselves to calm down.
And she did. Those feet did not land symmetrically. They kind of pitter-pattered as Montag turns the ball over. With the rock right now, it's Forest City.
Indians with 15 on the game clock. They get it out to Logos. Her three-point tries an air ball. It's too strong. Tracked down by Anderson of 10 seconds. Pass in the lane, intercepted by Montag of 8. Montag is in a triple team, and they foul her with 7.3 seconds left. A 15 foul on 4 City, and Garrigan will trek down to shoot.
What a play by Montag. 4 City has been doing that all night, getting that offensive rebound and then trying to go right back underneath the basket. Montag knew they were going to do that. She slices in there, intercepts the pass.
So 7.3 seconds left in this one, a 47-42 advantage by Bishop Garrigan. Montag tonight with 4 points as she'll head to the charity stripe. 83.3% from the line this season. Montag tees it up and she drills the first one. 48-42, Bishop Garrigan looking for top of Iowa West win number 63 in a row and win number 9 in a row against 4 City. Montag again. And this free throw rolls in, 49-42. We're down to 5 seconds left for City of Brown. Brown pulls up for a deep three-pointer, and it's left short. 2 seconds left, 1 second left. Out to Brown, three-pointer on the way. It's good, but it doesn't matter. That is the end of the game. Bishop Garrigan holds on for a 49-45 win. New year, same team. Wow. Bishop Garrigan is 7-0 in conference play. Their toughest test yet of the season in the top of Iowa West, and they hold on and end 4 City's 10-game win streak.
That was for the top of the conference. Now Garrigan will sit alone at the top of the conference. These teams will get a matchup again later on this season at Bishop Garrigan. Don't want to miss that one. It's going to be another exciting game between these two really quality teams here at the top of the Iowa Conference. 4 City and Bishop Garrigan really duking it out here tonight. What a comeback by 4 City. Down huge. I thought that was all she wrote. They come storming back to make it a 4-point game at the end.
Well, a great battle between two top 10 ranked teams in their respective classes, and it ends in Bishop Garrigan's favor. We'll step aside for a quick timeout, wrap it up next, and get you ready for the boys' game after this on 92.7 KLGA.
We've got more Sports Club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Algona Livestock, sales every Monday.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce, two sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services, view their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Holmes Animal Clinic, animals large and small, they love them all.
Style Salon, your salon in Algona, create yourself.
Dance Connection and Tumbling by Michelle. Passionate about teaching, creative about dance. Visit their studio or danceconnectionbymichelle.com.
TAFE Wellness Center in Algona and Armstrong. Keeping athletes in the game with chiropractic care. Take charge of your health.
Signworks for all of your signage needs, as well as printed shirts, caps, and jackets. Stop in or call 295-9544.
Down to Earth Tree Service, your local Algona tree service.
Sports Club members bringing you this game.
For over 40 years, Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons have maintained one mission: to provide excellence in orthopedic care. Their team of 9 physicians offer specialized care in everything from arthroscopic same-day surgery to joint replacement, as well as hand and foot surgery, and have an orthopedic surgeon on call 24/7. Healthcare isn't about appointments, it's about taking care of people, and that's their specialty. Visit Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons on the web at nwiabone.com.
Wrapping up game number one of our basketball doubleheaders, the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears stay undefeated in conference play. They are now 10-1 on the season and 7-0 in the top of Iowa West, defeating 4 City tonight, 49-45, hanging on by a thread in the fourth quarter. The scoring by quarter went like this. 4 City had a 14-13 scoring advantage in the first, but Bishop Garrigan had a 15-10 advantage in the second, going up by 4 at halftime. It was a big third quarter for the Golden Bears, getting some space between themselves and the Indians as they outscored the Indians 17-6 in the third, and then they nearly gave it all away in the fourth. Indians outscored the Bears 15-4, but that was enough for Bishop Garrigan to hold on for a 49-45 win and improve to 10-1 on the season and drop 4 City to 10-1. The individual scoring leaders look like this. For Bishop Garrigan, Graceland Eastman led the way with 16 points. Emmy Bartolo had 14, and Sasha Alish had 7, and Zoe Montag had 6. For 4 City, Hayden Brown had 20 points, Bethany Warren had 7, and Colette Logos with 6 points. I'm Tyler Lance. My partner is Beanie Bodie in this one tonight. And Beanie, as we expected, a close game between the two top teams in the conference, two teams that have really separated themselves so far, but ultimately Garrigan, they got on a nice run to start the third quarter. They were a little cold there in the fourth, but enough of a gap where they had that luxury to hang on at the end.
Yeah, that was a fun game. I came into this evening all mellow after the holiday break and seeing family and everything, but now I'm right back into high school basketball mode again. What a contest to start off this new year after the break. Two great teams. These two teams really check all the boxes. They both have great ball handling. They both play great defense. They both get good inside play. They both execute their offense really well. Like, just two real quality teams here in Forest City and Bishop Garrigan tonight on KLGA Hometown Radio. But it was the check box that wasn't checked off quite as well for Forest City was their offense. They went ice cold there in the end of the second, especially the third. Couldn't really get a bucket to fall, and Garrigan got hot. Emmy Bartolo really played a great third quarter. They both got good rebound. Capacious, as always, tearing up the rebounding column. Double-digit rebounds for Capacious yet again. And Garrigan just does everything they got. They have just what it takes. They got good post play from Eastman. They got rebounding from Capacious. They got great ball handling from Bartolo. And a couple great assists there by Olish for easy buckets. And, boy, they just stretch out that lead just enough, but not without a great comeback by Forest City, who did it all with some tenacious defense and just guts.
Well, Coach Erbling talked in the pregame show about how defense is really universal. It travels, and you can rely on it even when the offense is cold. And that defense allowed Forest City to get back into the game in the fourth quarter. But part of the reason why Bishop Garrigan had a big lead in the first place, once again, the great interior play of Graceland Eastman. The Golden Bear guards are really good about getting the ball across half court and immediately going, where is Graceland right now? Is she open for that floating rainbow pass inside? And so many times, especially in the second and third quarter, the Golden Bears found Eastman time after time.
Yeah.
Her touch around the bucket is great. And converting those opportunities were huge because Forest City missed a lot of point-blank shots. Garrigan made a lot of point-blank shots today, and that was really a big part of the difference.
Yeah, there was a stretch there where Forest City just could not buy a bucket inside. And you just got to shake your head as a coach and say, well, I guess that's the way it's going tonight. And meanwhile, Eastman's getting that ball inside. I don't even think she looks open. She looks like she's covered, but Garrigan is used to throwing that ball into crooks in double and triple coverage. They throw it anyway with Eastman. She might have someone in front of her, and they're so good at throwing that lob pass over the top, getting some easy buckets for the Garrigan post down low. And then really just opportunistic play by the guards of Bishop Garrigan. Zoe Montag there with a couple big steals. She get that big one to seal the game at the end of the fourth quarter. A lot of experience on that Garrigan team. And that's why they're not missing a step from last year. Even though they're young still, you know, Capacious, Murphy, Elena Casey being the seniors, there's just a ton of experience in intense, close games on that Bishop Garrigan team. And I didn't feel like they panicked much. I think I was panicking up here more than they were as that comeback was happening. They look cool as cucumbers down there as Forest City mounts that big comeback.
And it's always great to watch this matchup because this is really two of the better coaches in the top of Iowa West, moving the chess pieces around, of course. You know, we've talked about Coach Erpelding and the adjustments he made, but, you know, Coach Schwab, I said this earlier in the game, but he has a great feel of his team. He knows exactly when to take that timeout, give his team a breather. He knows, hey, you know, the man-to-man defense early in the game, Forest City had some success against that. We'll switch to the 2-3 and see if we can force them into some tougher shots that way. So I really felt both coaches moved a lot of chess pieces tonight, probably had more of a coaching duel than normal, but Coach Schwab ultimately pushed the right buttons tonight and really made some nice adjustments for the Bears.
Yeah, and just look, it's a 4-point game. You never know that razor-thin margin, a bucket here, a turnover there, and that's sports. That's the way it goes. That's all the difference. But both teams clearly got better tonight, I think, coming back from break. This is probably just what they needed to get the rest of their season started. I'm sure Coach Erpelding and Coach Schwab would like to play each other a few more times just for the experience because they make each other sharper. But, of course, Forest City, we'll have a lot of tough games. You said they played Clear Lake already this season. Now they got to focus on that conference schedule. But I don't see any other team in the top of Iowa Conference other than Forest City and Bishop Garrigan really challenging the rest of the way.
Well, Bishop Garrigan and Forest City have separated themselves, and now the Golden Bears have put a little bit of a gap between themselves and the Indians, but these teams, of course, will play one more time, but at Bishop Garrigan High School later on in January. Speaking of one more time, we have the boys game coming up here in about 8 minutes. Right now, we're going to step aside for a quick timeout and check in with Forest City head coach Dan Rosacker after this on 92.7 FM KLGA and the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
American Glass. For all your glass needs, think American.
Farm Bureau Financial Agents Dave Beisch, Jason Brace, Daniel Folk, and Michael Toth.
K
Kemco Tires, they're all you need to know about tires and service.
Weikert Realtors, the 515 Agency, a fresh approach to real estate.
Billy Offerman, your State Farm Insurance agent in Algona. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
BMC Advantage Insurance Services, insuring our neighbors for over 80 years.
Walker Chiropractic and Wellness, caring for Algona, Sway City, and the surrounding areas with chiropractic, nutritional, and physical therapy services.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
Getting ready for boys high school basketball action right now on Hometown Radio KLGA as it's the Forest City Indians against the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears. And right now we're joined by Forest City head coach Dan Rosacker. Coach, first of all, thank you for joining here on the pregame show and Happy New Year. How are you today?
Doing great. Happy New Year to you as well.
Well, Coach, let's talk a little bit about how your team spent their time over winter break, because obviously you get that little break a couple weeks here in the middle of the season to really kind of get back to practice and working on the fundamentals and just getting ready for the second half of the season in general. So overall, did you feel your team got a lot out of that time?
Yeah, I did. We were really battling the flu bug, I think, like a lot of people were before break. So just getting healthy was our main priority. But we played several games before break, which is kind of unusual with, you know, with the Iowa weather and everything. We got them all in. So we had a lot of things to go back and look at. Like you mentioned, we really focused in on some fundamental things that we needed to clean up, and then also looked at what was coming up. And we have a tough week here with Bishop Garrigan and Lake Mills coming in right off of break. So got a lot of things accomplished, really needed to get back to the practice court, and I really like the way we did things over break.
And, Coach, break is definitely a unique time and one where you can not only look ahead to the matchup against Bishop Garrigan, but also look a little bit at your own team and take a look at what they did in the first part of the season. So when you look at that start to the year, 5-4 overall for you guys and 5-1 in conference play, how would you evaluate that first part of the season?
Yeah, it's one of those, you know, I think we had a couple games that, you know, like a lot of teams always think we could have gotten, but you know, we just, for one reason or another, didn't execute well enough down the stretch to get those. And so a couple things I would have liked to have gotten, like to have another chance with, and some of those losses, those are things that you kind of always look at as a coach, but there are some things that we could have done a little differently to get a couple more wins, though. So, but we won the games we were supposed to. We were in some that, I think we could have gotten, and, you know, played some good competition as well in Clear Lake and Algona before break. So played some good teams, and I think we got better. I like the way our team's playing. I think there's a bright future ahead for this group as the season progresses. So saw a lot of good things. Just, you know, like anybody's going to say, there's a couple wins out there we wish we could have gotten, but we left out there. So looking forward as we move forward, though.
And, Coach, you talk about some of the improvements you've made, and certainly a team that's probably in a better spot right now than when they were this time last year. So what do you feel some of the improvements that this year's group have made over where they were at this point last season?
I think number one, I think we're rebounding much better than we did last year. I think that really hurt us last year. Also, I think offensively, we're still not where we want to be, but we're much more consistent than we were last year. So I think we're playing better as a team. We're moving the ball much better. And, you know, we're just overall competing. You know, even those games against, you know, better teams, even Clear Lake, you know, ranked number two in Class 3A, we were right with them for most of the game. And, you know, they just made some big buckets down the stretch to get a, you know, a 10-12 point win against us. I think it was something like that. So seeing some really good things, and, you know, defense has always been something we've kind of hung our hats on, and I really like the way these guys are competing. They're getting after it that side, that end of the court. So our offense is still a little bit behind, but hopefully we can get that going here as we move forward.
As you open up here in the month of January, right now it's a very fascinating race in the boys' top of Iowa West Conference with a lot of teams with just one loss so far and a couple teams still hanging around in contention. And you guys, of course, are right in the middle of it with a 5-1 conference record. So kind of taking a wide look at the upcoming part of your schedule, what are a couple things you need to see from your guys to stay in that top of Iowa race as you go throughout the month of January?
You know, I think it's just consistency. We need to get better at the offensive end, you know, to knock down big shots late in games, that sort of thing. And I think that's what I like from this group. I'm seeing guys that want to step up, and they're not afraid to, you know, they're kind of playing fearless. They're ready to take that shot if needed. So those are some things I'm looking for. Continue the rebounding in the defensive end is something, you know, you talk about those teams that are at the top of the league, you know, with Bishop Garrigan and Lake Mills and North Union. Those are all very good rebounding teams. They're athletic teams. So that's something we've really focused in on, not only in the preseason, but the offseason. So that's something we're going to continue to look at.
And Coach, speaking of Bishop Garrigan, that is who you guys welcome to your gym tonight with another big conference matchup. So looking at them, obviously you talk about the rebounding that they're able to do. What else stands out to you about the Golden Bears?
You know, they're just athletic. You know, they're young, a little bit young like us. They play a lot of young players. The main difference is one of their main guys, a freshman, you know, in the Joyce kid, who's a really good athlete and good player. And, you know, we've got to make sure we can contain him. And then Schwab from the outside is a good shooter. And then when you stretch out, you got Nemers inside. So they present a lot of problems. They get up and down the court very well. They run multiple defenses, which our kids are going to have to be ready for. So we just have to recognize what they're doing and match their intensity. They're going to play hard. They're going to play the right way, and that's just the way they've always done it. And we're going to need to identify shooters and at the same time be solid inside as well and protect the paint. So just be fundamentally sound overall. It should be a good basketball game.
Well, Coach, as we wrap up along those same lines, what do you feel is the number one key for a Four City win in tonight's game?
I think we just need to get our offense going. If we can make it a full-court game, get out and run a little bit and get our athletes involved, I think our depth has always been something with some teams we've played that has been a benefit for us. So if we can get up and down the court and get our defense going, that's going to be something we're going to be looking for sure.
Well, Coach, we appreciate your time today and wish you best of luck in tonight's game.
All right, thank you.
For City Head Coach Dan Rosacker. We'll step aside for a quick timeout and get back to more high school basketball coverage coming up on Hometown Radio KLGA and at the Elgona Radio YouTube stream.
We've got more sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Elgona Livestock, sales every Monday.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce, two sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services, view their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Holmes Animal Clinic, animals large and small, they love them all.
Style Salon, your salon in Elgona, create yourself.
Dance Connection and Tumbling by Michelle. Passionate about teaching, creative about dance. Visit their studio or danceconnectionbymichelle.com.
TAFE Wellness Center in Elgona and Armstrong. Keeping athletes in the game with chiropractic care. Take charge of your health.
Signworks for all of your signage needs, as well as printed shirts, caps, and jackets. Stop in or call 295-9544.
Down to Earth Tree Service, your local Elgona tree service.
Sports club members bringing you this game.
At Security State Bank, we realize each customer has a unique set of needs and goals. That's why we place a greater value on providing outstanding customer service. All products and services are designed for customers within our local community. We value each customer that walks through our door and wants to give them the personalized attention they deserve. Find out why Security State Bank in Elgona, Burt, and Laverne is your partner in community banking. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Security State Bank.
It's time to meet the starting lineup for the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears.
Drew Muller, Jr., number 23.
Outside Muller, he'll step back. Three on the way, and he sticks it.
Justin Bauer, senior, number 15.
Rises for a mid-range jumper, rolls off no good. The follow by Bauer, he put it in, he got fouled. Chance for a three-point play by Justin Bauer.
Logan Nemers, senior, number 42.
Lobs it into Nemers, on the block, takes a power dribble, puts it up and puts it in.
Carter Schwab, sophomore, number 24.
Now over to the right to Schwab, lets the free ball go, and he got it. Carter Schwab at the buzzer, drills his first three-pointer.
Michael Joyce, freshman, number 11.
And those plays going nowhere. Joyce picks it up in the backcourt, and he's going to flush it. Michael Joyce with the first throwdown of his high school career. Tip-off of your game is coming up next on Hometown and Home Country Radio. That is the Bishop Garrigan boys' starting lineup. Meanwhile, for the Forest City Indians and head coach Dan Rosacker, they will counter for the 6-foot senior Tommy Miller, the 6'2 junior Carson Hall, 6'3 junior Ty Dillavu, 6-foot sophomore Ty Sopko, and 6'5 junior Willie Holmes. The Forest City Indians, 5-4 so far this season, 5-1 in top of Iowa West play, as they are just half a game behind 6-1 North Union and 6-1 Lake Mills. Their lone loss, in fact, a 49-46 loss against North Union in conference play. Meanwhile, the Golden Bears, they are right there in that conference race, 6-4 overall, 4-2 in the conference. And Beanie, I'll tell you what, when North Union beat Lake Mills, that really opened up the conference race. This is a great four-team race, and these are two teams very, very involved in that race.
Yeah, boy, suddenly this race has heated up in the top of Iowa Conference. with North Union knocking off Lake Mills, and Garrigan, I think, is really coming on strong here in the second half of the season as they really start to come into their own, and this Forest City team suddenly playing outstanding. It's a toss-up. With a lot of basketball left to be played this year.
Yes, and it starts right now, right after Christmas break, as Logan Nemers is at midcourt for Bishop Garrigan. Nemers coming off a big game against St. Edmund right before the break in that 61-53 Garrigan win. As Nemers stands at 6'5", he'll go up against the 6'3", Ty Dillavue. Garrigan in the road black uniforms as Nemers does not win the tip. Ty Dillavue wins it. He taps it over to Willie Holmes, and we are underway from Forest City High School. Indians head from right to left on the radio dial. They're wearing the white uniforms with the red lettering and numbering on the front and back. Holmes with a handoff to Carson Hall. Hall left across the paint. Flings it into the corner, finding Dillavue. Dillavue gets it off to Miller. Miller jump stopping into the lane, finds Holmes. Holmes wide open, and he sets it in for two.
Nice assist there by Miller. Garrigan knows he likes to pull up for that jump shot, so they close out on him. He finds the easy bucket underneath. Good
Miller,
look.
Miller averaging 3.8 assists per game so far this season. His Nemers top of the key. Squares for a three-point ball. Missed it left. And sailing in for the rebound is Hall. 2-0 for City. 40 seconds gone in quarter number one as Hall deals it outside to Sopko. The 6-foot sophomore with the floater from the foul line, and he drops it right through.
Well, if this is any indication of the game in front of us, not going to be many shot clock issues tonight.
For City getting their first two shots off quickly, and Sopko, of course, that nice runner that we saw a lot from Miller last year, and a quick foul. It was Hall scrapping of Joyce, and Hall picks up the blocking foul against Forest City. So Garrigan will have the basketball off of the Forest City foul. Golden Bears scoring 64.4 points per game, number three in the conference. Forest City allowing 49.3. They're the number four ranked defense in the conference. Joyce has the inbound pass in the left corner as he's guarded by Hall, gets it up top to Schwab. Jumping out to defend him is Ty Sopko, getting right up in Schwab's face as Schwab heads left, drives in. Schwab gets all the way to the rack. He put it in. He drew the foul. Chance for a three-point play by Schwab.
Yeah, Sopko is guarding Schwab clear away from the basket. Putting one hand on him at a time. You put two hands on someone, it's an automatic foul call. But Sopko putting a lot of pressure on Schwab, and Schwab's got a big body, and he just says, I'm just going to barrel into you. I'm going to bowl my way to the basket, and he does just that. Gets the and one.
And Schwab knocks down the free throw to make it 4-3. Schwab averaging 12.9 points per game, shooting 55.6% for the foul line as Miller brings it across half court, wearing the high black socks as he hands the basketball off to Sopko. Sopko heads left across the foul line, bounce pass out to Hall, almost left it behind. Bauer pokes the basketball as the ball goes left to Dillavue. From the wing, shoots a three-pointer, and he rattles it in.
Dillavue's been getting better and better as we watch him over the years. Really solid player. Joyce handling the ball now. Him and Schwab, quite the tandem in the backcourt for Garrigan. Schwab, of course, always fun to watch him because, Tyler, he does not shy away from contact.
No, he does not. That's that offensive line mentality from football. Translating to the basketball court is Joyce from the lane, his jumper off the back of the cup, and Holmes skies in for the rebound. Hall runs up the floor for Forest City. Indians so far this season averaging 55.4 points per game, middle of the pack in scoring in the top of Iowa West. 6:02 on the clock, 7-3 Indians. Miller heads right around the perimeter as Justin Bauer defends. Now it's Dillavue. Dillavue wings the pass near side to Hall. Hall looking inside. He'll pass right instead and finding Sopko. Ball to the left corner, bobbled by Dillavue as he picks it back up with 5:48 on the clock and 10 on the shot clock. Hall takes a couple dribbles. Hall goes to work to the foul line, rising for a jumper, and he drew the foul right at the end of the shot clock.
Good elevation there by Hall. I guess I was wrong. They did use almost the whole shot clock. Looked like both teams were going to get out and run this ball. I thought we might have a score like in the 70s, but 7-3 at this point. Indians on top of the Bears.
So 5:43 on the clock. Hall will head to the free throw line where he's an 81.2% foul shooter. And the first free throw is up and good as the Indians have grabbed an 8-3 lead on their home court.
Boy, don't gloss over that. 81.2% free throw shooter. That's some solid numbers for a high school chucker.
Second free throw on the way, and that one is right through. Indians 9, Bears 3, early moments of the first quarter. Golden Bears have won their last three matchups against Forest City, including 74-57 and 58-55 last year. That 58-55 game was inside of this very gymnasium as Joyce gets it out to Mahler. Mahler across the paint towards the right, pump fakes, puts it up, and that one is way short. Nemers trying to scrap for the ball, but it's peeled away by Miller on the loose basketball. Miller across half court. Miller driving in. Miller takes it himself. Miller lays it in for two. And a timeout by Bishop Garrigan. 11-3 Forest City with a big start on their home court.
Yeah, really flowing well. Used that shot clock the whole possession previous. But other than that, it's been a lot of good movement straight to the basket for Forest City, not hesitating to get that ball inside.
and all five of their starters have scored so far. We see four twos on the scoreboard and the 1-3 belonging to Ty Dillavue, but they've shared the wealth so far, and right now they're beating Bishop Garrigan by a score of 11-3. Golden Bears 3 points coming off an and-one opportunity by Schwab.
You know, just our first look at this Four City team, they're a tough defensive matchup for anyone because they're all lanky, they're all very quick, so they don't have like the what I would call the traditional center that you put Logan Nemers on, and tough to decide how you're going to defend them, and I think that's probably what the Garrigan timeout was for, like how are we going to adjust our defense to stop these drives and these lane plays.
Bishop Garrigan has the ball as Joyce sets the screen for Schwab. Schwab's left wing gets it back to Joyce, edge of the Four City logo. Joyce picks up his dribble and finds Mahler top of the key. Now right wing to Schwab. Four City really jumping out on the Garrigan guards. Schwab across the foul line, hits the spin move, but did he hit the spin move too hard? Yes, he did, and he traveled.
Yeah, Schwab using that power. He has no problem getting himself into the lane. Just a little extra step once he was there. But I think you'll see a lot of that Schwab scoring inside tonight.
Four City goes to the bench. The 5'11 senior Sam Clausen and the 6'5 freshman Holden Reynolds come into the game. Carson Hall goes to the bench as well as Willie Holmes as the Indians have the rock right now. Reynolds passing it left as he finds Clausen. Now it's Sopko. Takes a couple dribbles. Now bounce pass to Clausen. Back over to Reynolds with 15 seconds on the shot clock. It's Miller. Miller gets the screen from Clausen. Pass goes back over to the right. Wide open Dillavue. His three-point ball is drained. 14-3 Indians.
Second three-pointer by Dillavue, and that's big because he's not someone that you're thinking is going to shoot a lot of threes. So you leave him out there, and he's drained a couple.
Ball knocked out of bounds away from Justin Bowers. The Golden Bears will keep it at 4:24 on the game clock. And an early hold to dig out of here in Four City, down 14-3. Schwab finds Bauer in the left corner. Now Nemers along the perimeter with 4:22 in the game clock. Back to Bauer in the corner as they survey the Indian defense. Joyce finds the basketball. Joyce passing it to Nemers. His baseline jumper is on the way, and it rattles home. Nemers from mid-range.
Nice touch by Nemers. They challenge him from out there. He'll hit him.
Nemers had a big game against St. Edmund. 23 points. 11 rebounds, and he shot 11 of 12 from the field in that win for Bishop Garrigan. Actually, 23 points, 13 rebounds as Four City gets the rock inside, and they get the two of Tommy Miller.
Well, that's the soft touch of Tommy Miller. It looked like that was going to be far wide right, and it somehow catches the rim, takes a spin back towards the hoop, and goes through.
Mahler has the top of the key, catches and fires on the three-pointer, but missed it right, and Miller sails in for an early rebound. Miller bumps into Bauer, gets by him, threads the pass up the court to Reynolds. Reynolds misses the point-blank layup, knocked out of bounds, last touch by Nemers.
You know, Reynolds comes in there wearing number 40. He's a big, tall guy. He's about an inch taller than Nemers there.
And we have another timeout on the floor. It'll be a 30-second timeout, this called by Four City. Actually, this one called by Garrigan, so they used two quick timeouts here and have three left.
I think they quickly saw something that they liked out there and want to take advantage of it next time they get that ball back. You know, offensively, Garrigan's having a hard time getting it going, and that's because those Four City guards are really putting a lot of pressure on Michael Joyce and Carter Schwab. I almost said Brandon Schwab. He's the coach of the girls. Carter Schwab, his son, is the guard for the Bears, and both those boys, Joyce and Schwab, have been dynamic scores for the Bears, and Coach Rosiker of Four City has said, we're going to try to take them out of the game, and the Four City guards have done just that so far.
Trayton Sink comes into the game for Bishop Garrigan, as Four City has Miller to inbound from along the baseline. Hall back in for the Indians as well, as Miller looks and finds Hall far side of the court. Rotates it around the perimeter to Clausen as he's picked up by Trayton Sink defensively. 3:30 on the clock, Miller back to Hall. Fakes and finds Miller in the corner. Miller drives baseline, shoots the floater over Nemers, and it bounces off the cup, no good. Rebound Reynolds, shot blocked by Nemers. Here come the Golden Bears with Joyce. Joyce drifts towards the far side. Now Joyce wants to drive. Pump fakes as the man flies by him as he kicks it out to Schwab. Foul line to Nemers, outside to Mahler. Tees up a three-point ball, and he finds the bottom of the net.
Big shot by Mahler. They're focusing on Joyce, leaving Mahler open. He can hit that three. Big answer for the Bears. They needed that.
Now a wide elbow jumper by Hall, off the heel, no good, and Sink has the rebound. Golden Bears inject a little bit of pace as here comes Schwab. Turns his back to the bucket, rotates to Mahler, off his fingertips as it rolls away. Mahler may have been getting ready to pull from that exact same spot if he had caught that pass cleanly, as the score is 16-8 right now for City. Joyce right wing comes top of the key to Schwab, guarded by Clausen. Schwab trying to spin his way in, kicks it out to Mahler. Right angle three-point ball, same spot, same result. Mahler hits it again.
Boy, 6 quick points for Mahler, keeping the Bears right in this 16-11.
2:28 on the clock, quarter number one. Miller goes right to Hall, now back to Miller, top of the key. Tommy Miller, 11.6 points per game for the Indians.
On 43.6% shooting, finds Hall over on the right side with 2:18 on the clock. A lob towards Miller in the right corner, now back to Hall. Top of the key to Reynolds. Pass knocked away by Schwab, out of bounds.
Boy, Garrigan got some good tempo there. They got that ball up the court quickly on offense. And get Mueller for that three. They're letting Drew Mueller shoot that three-point shot. They're going to have to change their mind about that because he can certainly shoot from outside. And, Tyler, we've liked that about Mueller for all these years. He's got such a versatile game both inside and outside.
No doubt. And early on, he's using the three-point shot, but he can take the ball inside and shoot from the mid-range as well, as Nick Lehrer checks in for Logan Nemers for Garrigan. Miller drives in, bumps into sink, finds Reynolds on the post, pivoting against Mueller. Tough shot, and he drew the foul at the very end of the shot clock as Reynolds heads to the free throw line for two. Reynolds so far this season, just one of two at the charity stripe, averaging 3.1 points per game off the bench for Four City. As it's 16-11 Indians, Four City will drop back here and leave just one rebounder in as the free throw is up and it's good, making it 17-11. Reynolds will set up for the second one with 2:02 on the clock in quarter number one. Spins it up and missed it off to the right as Lehrer snatches the rebound out of the sky. Schwab handles the ball for Garrigan. Behind the back dribbles, he heads right. Underhand to Sink in the corner. Sink drives baseline as he's caught up by Reynolds. Gets it out to Schwab beyond the perimeter with 1:51 left in quarter number one. The screen by Joyce. Schwab towards the far side. Now he wants to wrap the pass around to Sink. Ball peeled away. Reynolds shovels it back into play and saves it for Four City as the ball finds Dillavue. Dillavue across half court looking for Hall. Hall pinned between a couple defenders, gets it outside, finding Clausen with 1:33 on the clock. Clausen bounce pass to Miller on the wing, now Hall right corner. Lehrer out to defend, back to Miller with 1:27 on the clock. Hall again, lob into the post to Reynolds, knocked out of bounds by Mahler. Four City goes back to the bench. Holmes and Sopp go check in, and Reynolds and Clausen head to the pine. 17-11. Indians on top of the Bears. Miller to inbound from the near side of the court. Whips the pass into Hall in the corner. Pump fakes on the three. Drives baseline. Gets it right back to Miller. Drops and picks it up. Kicks it out. Free point ball. Sopko. Way short. Rebound into the pocket of Lehrer. Pops away from him. Hall's shot is blocked by Lehrer. And Schwab grabs the rebound. Schwab ahead to Joyce. Joyce drives baseline. Joyce takes contact. And that's a foul.
Boy, Garrigan really pushing that tempo. Trying to get those quick, easy buckets. Four City, on the other hand, doing exactly the opposite. Really trying to methodically work that ball around, use up that shot clock. 1:06 left to go in the first quarter. Boy, bring Lehrer off the bench there. He had a couple nice block there on that rebound as both coaches try to sub some players in and out.
That one was not an active shooting, so Schwab inbounds to Mahler. Mahler from just outside the corner. Rainbows the three up. It's no good. Holmes and Lehrer fight for the rebound, but Lehrer gets called for the foul.
Oh, that was an interesting one. We'll have to watch that one again on film. Holmes had the inside position. Lehrer had the elevation and the height. Could have been a tie-up situation, but here comes Tommy Miller with the possession for Four City.
Miller brings it across half court. Miller had 23 points and 17 points in the two matchups against Bishop Garrigan last year on a combined 19 of 30 shooting. Corner pocket three is swished. Ty Sopko knocks it down to make it 20-11. So Sopko gets in on the act. He has 5 points so far tonight. A nice cut by Sink. Sink with the floater, and Sink puts it in.
Oh, really good secondary transition offense by Bishop Garrigan.
20-13, Indians on top of the Golden Bears, down to the final 30 seconds of the quarter as the game clock and shot clock are virtually even right now. Florida City can be patient if they want to, as Miller has it at the edge of the FC logo at midcourt. Miller eyeing up Trayton Sink, flips it into the corner to Hall, who jumps and catches. Ball poked at by Joyce. Hall turns his back to the bucket and gets it back outside to Miller. 12 on the shot clock. Hall in the corner. Hall and a double team passes away. Miller spins from traffic. He shoots the runner. It's no good. Ball gets tipped. Pass goes into the corner to Sopko. His three-point ball is an air ball. Rebound by Holmes, and they will wave it off.
They're going to call either a hold on Michael Joyce. Yeah, they're going to call. Holmes was going in to get the rebound, and Michael Joyce kind of stuck a hand out and defrayed his ability a little bit there. Going to get called for a foul.
Foul number four against Bishop Garrigan. 2:09 left in the quarter. Miller to trigger. They get the shot up quickly. It's no good. Ball's tipped, and it's taken by Sink on the rebound, and that will be the end of the quarter as Dillavue can't push the shot in before the end of the first quarter. So Four City gets off to a good start at home. They lead Bishop Garrigan by a score of 20-13 right now on KLGA 92.7 and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
At Security State Bank, we focus on the needs of local families, businesses, and farmers. Decisions are made locally. We live and work in your neighborhood, helping to keep our local community vibrant and growing. We're involved in local community events. We believe in personalized service and advice that meets or exceeds your expectations. We're Security State Bank in Algona, Burt, and Laverne. Bankers who believe in you. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. Security State
Bank. For over 40 years, Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons have maintained one mission: to provide excellence in orthopedic care. Their team of nine physicians offer specialized care in everything from arthroscopic same-day surgery to joint replacement, as well as hand and foot surgery, and have an orthopedic surgeon on call 24/7. Healthcare isn't about appointments, it's about taking care of people, and that's their specialty. Visit Northwest Iowa Bone, Joint, and Sports Surgeons on the web at nwiabone.com.
Start of the second quarter here on Hometown Radio, KLGA Algona, as Forest City leads Bishop Garrigan 20-13. Indians got off to a 14-3 lead early, but Drew Mahler hit a couple of early threes as Mahler shoots the floater and he puts it in. 8 points by Drew Mahler.
Boy, he's got the hot hand. You got to find the guy with the hot hand, and it's Drew Mahler.
Forest City has Hall in the high post, kicks it out Dillavu, catch and shoot three-pointer, rims out, no good. Ball's tipped out of bounds, last touched by Holmes for Forest City as it goes back to Garrigan. 20-15 in favor of the Indians, trying to snap a three-game losing streak to Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears had Carter Schwamp scoring 21 and 15 points respectively in the two matches against Forest City last year, and he did it on a combined 15 of 23 shooting. Right now, Schwamp has an early three for the Golden Bears as Joyce fades back for a tough jumper off the back of the cup, no good. Ball loose and taken by Hall. Ready-made fast break for Forest City. Hall left of the paint. Hall sails in, and there's two by Carson Hall. 22-15 Indians as the Golden Bears come back the other way of Schwab. Schwab underhands it out to Lear, finds Sink, now far side. Gives it right back to Lear on the give and go. Lear's layup sits on the rim and drops through.
The classic give and go at work there for Garrigan.
Lear of his first two of the night, and it's 22-17 in favor of Forest City. Outside to Sopko, bounce pass finds Holmes. Ball knocked away by Joyce, and here's a steal. Joyce is going to run, trying to outsprint the Indian defense. Joyce hangs in the air. Layup no good. Rebound is ripped away by Dillavu, and he has it for Forest City. Up quickly to Miller. Miller up to Hall. Hall in the paint. Hall jumps, and Hall's shot rolls in.
Well, now Forest City matching the Garrigan tempo. Both teams willing to go back and forth.
24-17 in favor of Forest City. We know Garrigan likes to play fast, and Coach Rosacker said in his pregame interview he wanted to see a little pace from his offense tonight. Schwab drives baseline, gets all the way inside. Tough angle shot, no good, and Miller grabs the rebound. Back the other way come the Indians. Hall jumps and passes to the far side of the court, but it's out of bounds, out of the reach of Sofko. Indians go back to the bench. The senior Greg Smith coming in for the first time tonight, as well as the freshman Holden Reynolds, as heading to the bench will be Dillavu and Holmes.
Drew Muller's going to get a break. Nemers comes in for him. Drew Mahler, the leading scorer for Garrigan thus far tonight. Typically, it's Schwab and Joyce are the leading scorers for Garrigan, but Forest City defense doing a nice job on them tonight so far.
Joyce up top, handling the basketball. The Bishop Garrigan freshman gets it out to Nemers. Just to left the center, right back to Joyce. Nemers screens. Joyce sidestepped into a three-pointer. Line drive it no good as Smith has the rebound for Forest City. Indians get it up quickly. It's Reynolds. Reynolds right on the paint. Out to Miller. Catch and fire free. Point ball, and he swishes it. And then he waves to his own student section as it's a 10-point lead. Miller able to hit from range, had come into tonight shooting just 19% on three-point balls. Lear in the paint finds Nemers, fought about the jumper, got it right back to Sink. Sink underneath, and he traveled. Sink got the good inside position, but Garrigan will ultimately turn it over on that possession. Handling the basketball right now is going to be Miller for Forest City, as Miller walks it across half court. Down to 5:30 in quarter number two. It's a 10-point Indian lead. Miller up top, pump fakes, now gets it right to Hall. Into the corner, he finds Sopko. The Forest City sophomore starts his dribble. And we are going to see a foul against Joyce for Bishop Garrigan. That'll be his second personal foul, Bishop Garrigan's first of the quarter. As Tate Furch comes into the game to replace Trayton Sink. Justin Bauer coming in to replace Joyce for the Golden Bears. And Hall the inbound for the Indians. The 6'2 junior averaging 9.7 points per game so far as he gives it to Miller. We're 5:19 on the clock.
into the high post to Reynolds. Kicks it into the corner to Sopko. Sopko driving in. Gets it back outside to Miller. Miller hits the spin move. Rises for the jumper. Can't push the shot in. Smith offensive rebound and he'll kick it out for Forest City. Driving in Sopko. And stop everything because there's a push by Bishop Garrigan. And a foul by the Golden Bears. That'll be their second of the quarter. That'll be number two against Nick Lear. So Miller from the baseline. Miller looks, trying to lob it into Smith, almost tipped away by Lear, and Forsyth stepped out of bounds. Miller was too far to the baseline.
Yeah, Miller hadn't gotten himself completely inbounds after he inbounded the ball. His left foot hadn't come in on the court of play yet. Right there with the call. Gives it right back to Garrigan. 27-17 is the score. Garrigan could use a bucket here, cut into that lead.
Mahler checks right back in as Lear heads to the bench. Furch is blitzed in the corner. Furch is fouled. Miller fouled him as Miller was campaigning for a jump ball that time, but he'll get his foul on Forest City instead, his second personal.
Yeah, we were able to be here in time to catch some of this JV boys game, and Furch did a lot of the ball handling for the JV in two quarters of that JV game. Looked real good.
Furch pops out near half court, guarded by Reynolds to collect the basketball. Lobs the pass near side to Schwab. Schwab rises up for a three-point ball, and he finds the bottom of the net. Schwab will get the Bishop Garrigan offense going there for three-pointers. It's 27-20. 6 points by Carter Schwab so far tonight. Schwab came in shooting 35% on three-point balls. As Forest City has it with Reynolds up top. A bullet pass almost dropped by Sopko. Got it out to Hall. Hall gets in, rises for a jumper, and he knocks it down. Hall finds a spot, makes it 29-24 City.
Here comes Carter Schwab, feeling it after that three-pointer. Look for him to score again.
Bauer bounces the pass to Nemers, finds a wide-open Mahler, and Mahler's layup is no good. Rebound gets tipped out to Miller. Quickly running up the floor is Hall. Hall left of the paint, goes right into Nemers. Shot is no good. Rebound tipped all the way out to Mahler, and now Mahler runs the other way. Mahler onto the wing, finds the trailing Schwab. Now Schwab looking for the baseline, driving in, tried to kick it back out to Mahler as he fell down. Pass goes to Miller. Up the court to Hall. Hall in the lane, rises up, jumper short. The follow is up, and it's good by Sopko.
It was some helter-skelter basketball happening now. Here comes Schwab with the ball. Garrigan had a great execution on that last play. Can they do it again?
Furch, three-point ball blocked by Reynolds. It goes into the pocket of Nemers, though. As Nemers throws it away, Hall tiptoes the sideline and stays in bounds. Hall up to Miller. Miller catches, doesn't even land, and he lays it in. Forest City up 33-20, and the Indians have the energy right back as Bishop Garrigan is forced to call a timeout. We'll take that timeout with the Bishop Garrigan coaches and come back after this on 92.7 KLGA.
We've got more Sports Club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Reeves Wicked Good Bar and Grill. For wicked good food, drinks, and service, you gotta go to Reeves.
CB Grain Solutions. Satisfaction guaranteed.
New Way K&H Co-op. Delivering exceptional value through knowledge and innovation.
Dump It. They do the dirty work so you don't have to.
Albert Electric. Flip the switch to Albert Electric.
Grassmasters, growing satisfied customers.
Greg Penning and Company, certified public accountants, where everyone counts.
Yemlin Builders and Apartments, quality apartments for rent, beauty and craftsmanship that will never go out of style.
Daylight Donuts, open early with delicious donuts and great coffee.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
Garrigan trying to find a way to turn up the energy coming out of the timeout as right now they trail at Forest City 33-20. Mahler gives to Schwab, rises for a three-pointer but missed it left, and Smith secures the rebound for the Indians. 3:20 left in the first half. High pass to Reynolds and way too high. Look out, Forest City cheerleaders, as that one drills one of them down there on the pass as it's out of bounds.
I think Forest City might have been trying to do some sort of alley-oop there. Maybe not for the dunk, but maybe for another tip-in. But I'll get the right ball right back to Garrigan, down 13. Schwab getting it going here, fires up to Bauer.
Forest City has spread the wealth around scoring so far as Mahler shoots the elbow jumper, rolls off the cup, no good, and Hall has the rebound for Forest City. Out to Reynolds. Reynolds lets two defenders fly by, and he rolls the shot in. 15-point lead for Forest City just like that. Bauer drives the other way, got inside, but rejected by Hall as he shovels the basketball out of bounds. Well, Forest City has all kinds of energy, and they love that defensive play by their junior Carson Hall as the whole bench rose up for that one. Near side of the court, it's Schwab inbounding to Mahler in the right corner with 2:54 left in the first half. Mahler takes a couple of dribbles and gets to the wing. Now top of the key to Schwab. Gets left to Bauer. Wide open three-pointer. Left it a little bit short, and the rebound is tracked down by Reynolds. Coming into the front court is Cooper Blazer, the freshman for Forest City. Blazer averaging 2 points per game off the bench for the Indians, wearing jersey number 21, and gets his first action of the night. Hall holds the basketball near half court as the Indians are having a methodical possession here. Handoff goes to Clausen, drop the ball, trying to pick it back up. Joyce couldn't get there in time. Pass goes to Hall, he's open in the corner, and he drills another three-point ball. 11 points by Carson Hall, and Forest City pouring it on up 38-20. Schwab to Bauer. Bauer drives baseline. Bounce pass out to Mahler. Catch and shoot three, and he answers right back.
Hey, Mahler has been the bright spot in this offense. His third three of the game falls. Forest City really picking up the tempo. They're right back at us.
38-23 in favor of the Indians. Back to the bucket. Working his way in is Reynolds, and a whistle and a turnover by Forest City with 1:59 on the clock.
Reynolds was trying to hit that spin move, Tyler, that we like, and he shuffled his feet. Getting ready for the setup.
They do. It's effective when you don't travel, but they'll get you a lot for a travel on that one. It's still a 15-point game right now. Schwab has the basketball for Bishop Garrigan. 1:53 left in the first half. Schwab behind the back dribble finds Bauer near side of the court. Bauer picks up his dribble. Bauer, top of the key to Mahler. Mahler takes one dribble to the right, gives it to Schwab on the wing. Schwab around the screen from Joyce around the top of the key. Left of the paint, deals to Bauer in the corner. Now back to Joyce, left wing. 1:38 left in the first half. Schwab screening, Joyce holding. Joyce towards the corner. Can't shake loose as he gets the ball back to Schwab. 9 on the shot clock. Forest City for really good defensive possession so far. 6 on the shot clock. Top of the key, Joyce trying to get the three-pointer off, and it rolls off the rim. No good. Really good defense there by Forest City for about 30 seconds as the Indians have Delavue crossed half court. Handoff goes to Blazer, now back over to left to Clausen. 1:14 left in the first half. Top of the key, Reynolds, as he'll get the pass quickly over to the right to Blazer. Blazer takes one dribble and comes to the top of the key to Sopko. 18 seconds on the shot clock. Clausen on the left wing. Clausen, couple dribbles towards the right, gives it off to Blazer. 10 seconds on the shot clock as Blazer's near the half-court logo. Bauer creeps out to defend. The screen by Reynolds. Blazer 5 seconds. Blazer left to the bucket, and he and Bauer take a huge collision and a foul on Bishop Garrigan as Blazer will shoot two.
Wow, that was a big-time block by Bauer. I know he got called for the foul, but he stuck with him hip-to-hip all the way, like playing cornerback in the football field. He goes up and just mosses that ball right out, but gets called for a foul there. And they both hit the deck. That was exciting.
Yeah, you could probably hear the sound of the bodies hitting the floor all the way up here in the press box. And we are up pretty high in Forest City as the free throw is rattled in by Blazer to make it 39-23.
Yeah, Justin Bauer, the senior, he's a tough kid. You know, he's playing hard all the time. He's got a knee brace on that left knee. And he's not happy about this 40-23 deficit. And Nemers is in there. See if they get the big man going here. Garrigan just having a hard time getting any offense going, Tyler. A lot of that, give credit to the opponent here, Forest City really playing hard defense. They've done such a good job of swarming Schwab and Joyce. Every time they get a corner turn and get past their first defender, there's two more right there.
Well, Joyce of 0 points so far and Schwab of 6, and that is a first half that Forest City would absolutely sign up for as Bauer tees up a three-point ball, and it's an air ball. Hall picks it up along the baseline and gets it into Reynolds with 38 seconds left in the first half, and the Golden Bears have another empty possession. Hall across the half-court timeline. 3 second difference between game clock and shot clock as we're down to 28 on the game clock. Near half court, Hall is going to burn a little clock with Forest City now leading 39-23. They've apparently changed a three-pointer to a two on the scoreboard somewhere along the line as a spin move, blowing a tire to Sopko, but he got it off to Reynolds safely. Reynolds into the lane, Reynolds driving in, and the layup rolls off no good. Offensive board for Delavue, and he gets it out of 10 seconds. Shot clock is now off. Forest City has the ball in the right corner of Delavue, inside to Reynolds. Reynolds back out. And still find Sopko. Sopko of 2. Sopko, tough shot. Bothered by Nemers at the buzzer, and it's no good. Golden Bears hold on that last possession, but it was all Forest City in the first half. Indians take a 39-23 lead into the halftime locker room as we'll step aside for a timeout and come back with halftime coverage after this on 92.7 KLGA and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
We've got more Sports Club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Algona Livestock, sales every Monday.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce, 2 sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services, view their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Holmes Animal Clinic, animals large and small, they love them all.
Style Salon, your salon in Algona, create yourself.
Dance Connection and Tumbling by Michelle,
passionate about teaching, creative about dance, visit their studio or danceconnectionbymichelle.com.
TAFE Wellness Center in Algona and Armstrong, keeping athletes in the game with chiropractic care. Take charge of your health.
SignWorks for all of your signage needs, as well as printed shirts, caps, and jackets. Stop in or call 295-9544.
Down to Earth Tree Service, your local Algona Tree Service.
Sports Club members bringing you this game. High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
American Glass, for all your glass needs, think American.
Farm Bureau Financial Agents Dave Beich, Jason Brace, Daniel Folk, and Michael Toth.
Kemco Tires, they're all you need to know about tires and service.
Weikert Realtors, the 515 Agency, a fresh approach to real estate.
Billy Offerman, your State Farm Insurance Agent in Algona. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Iowa Lakes Community College, your community, your college.
Lusher Family Dentistry, serving your family since 1965 on Call Street in Algona.
BMC Advantage Insurance Services, insuring our neighbors for over 80 years.
Walker Chiropractic and Wellness, caring for Algona, Sway City, and the surrounding areas with chiropractic, nutritional, and physical therapy services.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
When you need cash on the go, there's no need to pay a surcharge fee with MoneyPass. Iowa State Bank is proud to be part of the MoneyPass network of surcharge-free ATMs found nationwide. Look for the green and blue MoneyPass symbol on over 32,000 ATMs across the nation. Or find an ATM near your vacation spot or travel destination at MoneyPass.com. MoneyPass, another way that Iowa State Bank helps people succeed. Member FDIC.
Time right now on Hometown Radio KLGA is the Four City Indians lead the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears by a score of 39-23. Right now we're joined by Bishop Garrigan girls head coach Brandon Schwab, recapping game number one of our doubleheader, a 49-45 win by the Golden Bears. Coach, first of all, great to come out of winter break, get a big Top of Iowa test against another undefeated opponent in the conference to get that early win. So, you know, I think there's always some concern coming out of break of just how teams will look not playing a game, you know, for about 2 weeks there. But overall, you know, how did you feel the team came out of the locker room tonight?
You know, I really thought for three quarters we played pretty well, and then we kind of ran out of gas. We didn't execute, you know, we were taking shots that you know, we don't need to take with a 15-point lead. You know, we needed to get the ball to Gracelyn a little more inside down the stretch. I mean, she was a matchup problem for them, and you know, we didn't finish the game inside like we needed to, but I really thought we executed for three quarters really well, offensively and defensively. We made a lot of things tough on them, you know, especially in that third quarter. You know, they didn't get a lot of good looks. You know, I mean, we were moving. I thought our zone, you know, I played way more zone than I really anticipated tonight. I thought it was going to be a 90% man night, and, you know, the way we went to zone a little bit in the second quarter, and I really liked we had only gave up 1 3-point attempt in the second quarter compared to seven or eight in the first quarter. And one of our keys were we needed to not exchange threes with them. We needed to get them off the three-point arc, and we needed to get them go one and done. We didn't rebound as well as I thought, but, you know, I really thought we made things tough on them.
Well, Coach, you mentioned going from a man to a zone defense, and you called that timeout early in the game. You switched over to a zone. What were a couple drivers of that decision, A, to go to the zone, and B, to stay in the zone for the majority of the night?
Well, you know, a couple of the things were is fatigue. You know, Sasha hadn't practiced over break. She tweaked her groin first practice back out of break, so she had not had the legs under. We literally shut her down until tonight, and she started tonight. So she's ran up and down the floor one time since our last game. So, you know, I mean, that some of it had to do with were we going to be able to withstand that and be able to keep legs enough to finish the game.
Well, Coach, you got in a good position to finish the game because during that third quarter, I believe you outscored Four City. It was 17-5 or 17-6, yeah. But in either case, really good third quarter. What were a couple of big things you saw during that quarter as you built that 15-point lead?
You know, I thought we were sharing the ball very well. I thought we were the aggressor in the third quarter. I thought we came out of the locker room and really were the aggressor and played downhill. And I really think that was, you know, that third quarter run was the difference in the game. We really came out of the locker room and really did some nice things offensively. I mean, I really thought, you know, we put some new twists in offensively over break, and I thought we executed a lot of them in the first three quarters that pretty well, I thought.
Well, and Coach, obviously the game didn't finish the way you wanted to as far as closing out with an exclamation point, but it did end with a win. So even though you have a few things to work on coming out of the fourth quarter, you get to work on it in a win. So what do you want the players to kind of learn from the last 6, 7, 8 minutes of that game?
Well, I mean, just not letting their pressure dictate the pace that we play. You know, I mean, there's no reason Eastman only gets one or two touches in that fourth quarter. You know, when you've got that lead, the ball's got to go and finish inside, and we needed to flex our muscles a little bit that way. And, you know, but this is the first time this group has been in that position, you know, in the fourth against a highly ranked 3A squad. You know, the Newell game was out of hand kind of in the fourth. We didn't put – you know, things got tight there, and we didn't have, you know, I mean, with some young guards and some young posts on the floor, it was good for us to grow up and get reality. Obviously, I like learning some things off of a win. I don't really enjoy learning them off of a loss. So we learned some things tonight. We'll get back in practice. We'll put in a little more pressure defense, game to make sure we know where the ball needs to go at that moment. But, you know, kids were trying to make plays all night, and I don't fault their effort. They were trying to make plays. Our kids played extremely hard, and you know, we said before the game we're going to have to drain the tank, and, you know, we drained the tank tonight. So it's a big, big road win against a ranked 3A team, and we'll get back in practice for a couple days and make some adjustments and get back after it Friday.
Well, Coach, congratulations on the big win tonight, and we'll talk to you leading into the West Hancock game on Friday.
Okay, thanks, Tyler.
That is Bishop Garrigan head coach Brandon Schwab here at halftime, as we'll step aside for another timeout and bring you the second half of boys action after this on 92.7 KLGA and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
We've got more sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Algona Livestock, sales every Monday.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce, two sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services, view their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Holmes Animal Clinic, animals large and small, they love them all.
Style Salon, your salon in Algona, create yourself.
Dance Connection and Tumbling by Michelle, passionate about teaching, creative about dance. Visit their studio or danceconnectionbymichelle.com.
TAFE Wellness Center in Algona and Armstrong, keeping athletes in the game with chiropractic care. Take charge of your health.
Signworks, for all of your signage needs, as well as printed shirts, caps, and jackets. Stop in or call 295-9544.
Down to Earth Tree Service, your local Algona Tree Service.
Sports Club members bringing you this game.
At Security State Bank, we focus on the needs of local families, businesses, and farmers. Decisions are made locally. We live and work in your neighborhood, helping to keep our local community vibrant and growing. We're involved in local community events. We believe in personalized service and advice that meets or exceeds your expectations. We're Security State Bank in Algona, Burt, and Laverne. Bankers who believe in you. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. Security State
Bank. Thank you to these sports club members bringing you this game on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Kossuth Regional Health Center, make KRHC your home for health care.
Tom Eichen Sales, your store in the country, carrying steel and Toro products and Green Mountain pellet grills.
Algona Plumbing and Heating, where a good flush always beats a full house.
Runke Brothers Full Service. Experience the Runke Brothers difference for all your auto service and repair needs.
Herpelding Boyd & Company CPAs, they're not just about taxes.
Hy-Vee, use the Fuel Saver card. Fill your cart, fuel your car.
North Iowa Appliance Center, Highway 18 East in Algona, where they sell the best and service the rest.
Herpelding Excavating Enterprises, let them take care of your grading, excavating, and drainage needs.
AK's Chrome Kitchen. When you come in, your family.
All sponsors of this game broadcast.
Bishop Garrigan have a lot of work to do in the second half as they trail the Forest City Indians right now, 39-23. Indians outscored the Golden Bears 20-13 in the first quarter and 19-10 in the second quarter to build this halftime lead. Right now, Michael Joyce of 0 points, Carter Schromm just six. Drew Mahler's the leading scorer of 9 points for Bishop Garrigan, while on the Forest City side, Carson Hall has 11, Tommy Miller has 9, Ty Sopko has 7, and Ty Dillavue has 6. Beanie, the biggest thing Garrigan needs to do in the second half to get back into it is what?
Well, take advantage of whatever Forest City's going to give them. They've clearly made a concerted effort to take out the backcourt. So the front court, Nemers and company, is going to have to get some points down there.
Yeah, not a lot of scoring in the paint so far tonight either for Bishop Garrigan, as Nemers has just 2 points tonight. Nick Lear also of two. Forest City has the basketball heading left to right on the radio dial. The floater by Miller, no good from the foul line, and Joyce snatches the rebound. Joyce brings some pace across half court, jumping into the lane, getting to the cup. He scored it, and he got fouled. Michael Joyce starting the second half the right way.
Wow, just as we start to question Joyce's scoring, he goes coast to coast, one on team, and still gets to the bucket, puts it in, and the foul. Garrigan could certainly use some points from him, but as I said, Forest City is really, really playing tough defense on the Garrigan backcourt.
Michael Joyce heads to the free throw line, a 60% free throw shooter, as his foul shot rolls in. Garrigan got the bounce they needed on that one. It's a 39-26 game. As Miller brings the ball across half court for Forest City with 9 points in the first half. Deals to Hall in the right corner, make that the left corner. As Dillavue now has it at the foul line. Dillavue dancing and kicking out to Miller near side of the court. Guarded by Bauer. Miller into the paint. Floats it over Nemers. And the ball rolls in. Miller into double digits of 11 now. 41-26 as Joyce stays out of trouble and gets it into the front court. Top of the key now to Schwab. Back to the left wing to Joyce. Joyce into the lane. Joyce down the center of the paint. And he draws the foul.
Yeah, two fouls on the Indians. Both on Michael Joyce driving strong to the hoop. Both Joyce and Schwab love to drive hard to that hoop, make something good happen, even if it's a foul. Bears will inbound it with Nemers and Muller down low.
Second foul against Carson Hall as Nemers has the ball peeled away by Holmes, and he steals it for Forest City, but then he throws it right back to Muller for Garrigan. Hands it off to Schwab, bounces to Joyce. Joyce shoots the three, but he was stepping out of bounds as he was out of bounds along the far side. So Garrigan will turn it back over to Forest City, down 41-26. Golden Bears coming in at 6-4 overall, 4-2 in top of Iowa West play. A crowd at top of the conference. Lake Mills 6-1, North Union 6-1, Forest City 5-1, Garrigan 4-2, and then Eagle Grove 4-3 right behind them. So the top of the top of Iowa West has gotten very interesting for the first part of the season. Miller right side, bullets it into the paint, and the shot is no good, but Dillavue got fouled. Ty Dillavue shoot 2 for Forest City.
Just run an offensive quick hitter there where they bring a player across the baseline. Miller sees him coming. A set play. Muller got his body there, but got contact with his arms on the way up.
Dillavue 3-5 so far at the charity stripe this season. As the first shot on the way, and it pops off the cup, no good. Thomas and Lear are getting set to check in for Bishop Garrigan as they will replace Muller and Nemers. First time we've seen Amari Thomas play so far tonight, has that right hand still taped up for Bishop Garrigan, something that we saw before winter break as well.
Yeah, it looks like he's trying to stabilize that thumb with that tape job. Dillavue at the line hit a couple big three-pointers in the first half.
And free throw in and out, no good. That ball went about three-quarters of the way down before popping out of the cup. Bauer the other way, runs right into the lap of Miller, and Miller fouls. That is the third foul on Tommy Miller, and Bauer did not see Miller in front of him. Oh, no, check that. That's on Bauer. I beg your pardon.
Oh, wow. Yeah, so Garrigan made the long pass up the court to Bauer, and Miller was right there to meet him with it. And Bauer gets called for a push, I guess.
Miller had me fooled there because he was looking at the ref as if he was the one who committed the foul, but it was Bauer who gets called for that one as Bauer picks up his second. Sopko on the right side finds Holmes into the post. Power dribble by Dillavue. Shot no good from point-blank range. In and out. Thomas grabs the rebound for Bishop Garrigan. Schwab into the front court. Behind the back dribble. Enters the paint. Shoots the floater. And it drops in with a soft touch.
Oh, nice drive by Schwab. He goes coast to coast after the big board by Thomas. Garrigan scoring well in transition to get back in this game. It's 41-28.
41-28. Miller has it at the edge of the Forest City logo. Bauer pokes the basketball. Now it's Sopko curling around toward the right. Sopko hits the spin move, deals it to Hall on the right wing, guarded by Michael Joyce. Hall across the foul line, jumps and passes to Miller, far side of the court. Works the baseline, finds Holmes. Holmes in traffic, shot blocked by Lear. Forest City got it back of Miller, though, as he kicks it out to Dillavue. 8 on the shot clock. It's Miller bumping into Bauer, and that'll be a foul on Bishop Garrigan's senior Justin Bauer.
Oh, just about 6 seconds left in the shot clock. When Bauer picks up that foul, that'll reset the shot clock back to 35 for Forest City.
Bishop Garrigan is a team that fouls quite a bit. They're committing over 16 fouls per game, most in the top of Iowa West, as Tate Furch checks in for Justin Bauer. A new 35 on the shot clock for Forest City. As Sofko handles the rock, he's scoring 12.6 points per game as he bursts inside. Shot blocked, but another foul. That is number four against Bishop Garrigan as Lear's jaws on the floor. And the Golden Bears getting an early foul trouble here in the third quarter.
Well, Lear likes to block shots. He had one about 30 seconds ago. Tried to pick up a second one right there. Ref calls him for the foul. A little bit of a delayed call. That always gets the ire of the player.
Sofko is going to shoot two here. Came into tonight 3 of 4 at the foul line as he rattles the first one in and puts Forest City up 42-28.
Lear, of course, Tyler, is the classic basketball player. He never thinks he committed a foul. He's had zero fouls in his high school career so far.
And he's had a lot of fouls this season for Bishop Garrigan. He's an aggressive defender. He'll get some blocks, but he'll pick up his fair share of fouls as well as the free throw is good.
Yeah, zero fouls if you ask him, of course.
Yes, of course. Schwab across half court. Left of the paint. Schwab trying to take it coast to coast, and he'll draw a foul as well. This game turning into a foul fest all of a sudden in the third quarter as Forest City gets tagged for their third and the third personal on Hall.
Yeah, so far 7 total fouls in the half. You know, go back to that girls game. I think there wasn't even 7 fouls in the entire game.
Yeah, the girls game had pretty much nonstop action. Very few timeouts called, very few fouls committed as Furch has it top of the key. Left open for a 3-point ball, missed it left. Thomas tried to tap the rebound and keep it alive, but he tapped it out of bounds as Forest City gets it back.
Yo, Thomas and Lear are in there. Together, really have some height. They really battle for the boards. They don't have the size that Nemers has, but they can sky and get up there and really play around the rim.
Ball's kicked out towards the right side to Carson Hall. Hall finds the elbow, and he gets it around to Dillavu. Dillavu back to the top of the key, finding Sofko. Sets himself for a 3-point look. Missed it left. Offensive rebound, though, for Dillavu, and he got it back out to Miller. Miller stopped along the baseline by Lear, gets it into the corner to Dillavu. With 4:57 left in the third quarter, Forest City maintaining a 43-28 lead over Bishop Garrigan as Joyce tries to jump a pass near half court. Hall keeps it safe, drives right of the paint, fades with a jumper, shot no good. That was a tough shot. Ball pops loose. It goes right into the pocket of Holmes. Holmes in the paint, fights it through contact, and he draws the foul. Forest City wins the scramble drill that time, and Holmes will shoot 2 free throws.
Yeah, just a lot of, I guess I'll call it ugly basketball so far this quarter. A lot of fouls, a lot of helter-skelter plays, running the floor. Officials having a call. We make a lot of calls here as Garrigan tries to claw their way back in it. Forest City offense doesn't look very smooth at this point. Credit to the Garrigan defense.
We'll call it post-winter break basketball.
Yeah, post-winter break basketball.
As Holmes rattles in the first free throw.
You know, a lot of these teams do play opponents over the Christmas break. Coaches like to try to schedule a scrimmage, come in on the 27th, 28th, somewhere around that time, help these teams play against someone other than each other. But both these teams have pretty big squads. Can pull off pretty good scrimmage right at their own practice.
Holmes tees up the second one, and he knocks it down. A couple free throws there by Willie Holmes to make it 45-28, and Holmes will head to the bench as Reynolds checks back in.
Reynolds, tallest player on the floor, the center for Forest City at this point.
4:38 left, quarter number 3. Furch has it on the left wing, guarded by Miller. Up top to Joyce, finds Thomas. Thomas working in the post, rises up, shot partially tipped. Furch got it back, and that's a foul. Yep, Reynolds took a big swing at that ball and then swung down on Furch as he'll head to the line for 2.
Yeah, Reynolds a solid foot taller than Furch, it looks like. Furch goes up against him. Reynolds swats him and the ball and more. Boy, Lear in there playing with 4 fouls. They're just going to roll the dice and let Lear see how long he can stay in the game. He's got that shot-blocking presence.
And Furch has the friendly rubber on the first free throw, knocks it down to make it 45-29. Furch came in tonight 3 of 8 at the foul line as the Golden Bears sophomore tees up the second one. And he spins it in, 45-30. Now Furch will guard Miller as Miller brings it across half court along the far side. Pass goes to Clausen, who just checked in as Thomas defends along the perimeter. 4:18 left, quarter number 3. Miller near side finds the cutting Reynolds in the paint. Reynolds shoots it over Lear, and he puts it in. Lear did a good job staying vertical that time, but it's 47-30 for City. 5 points by Reynolds. Ball rolls away in the backcourt, or in the front court, that is. It was touched out of bounds by Miller, and Bishop Garrigan will keep it.
You know, it seems like Garrigan has clawed their way back in a little bit, but it's still a 17-point advantage for Forest City because every time Garrigan seems to get a little something going, get a bucket, Forest City is quick with the answer.
Schwab, a bounce pass into Joyce with 4:03 in the clock. To the right side to Furch. Right of the paint, and Furch travels.
He slammed on the brakes and his feet slid. He wipes them off with his hands, but too late, can't get that travel back, as Garrigan's going to employ a little bit of a full court press here.
Mahler will check in as Lear heads to the bench. Drew Mahler with 9 points so far tonight. As the Golden Bears defend, Furch will face guard Miller. They'll get it into Clausen instead. Clausen up ahead to Reynolds. Reynolds to the foul line. Turns his back and gets it outside to Dillavue, top of the key. Schwab creeps up to defend as Dillavue takes one dribble towards the right and gives it to Miller. Miller forced back towards the 4-City logo by Schwab. Pass goes near side to Smith. Smith defended by Thomas. Bounce pass to Dillavue. Underhands it out to Reynolds as he rotates it around to Miller with 14 seconds on the shot clock. Ball goes inside. Dillavue deep in the post. Fades, puts it up and in. 49-34 City. Dillavue getting great position inside as he has 8 points tonight. Schwab dances down the lane, takes a little elbow by Smith, and a blocking foul on 4-City's number 54. Their 15th foul as Schwab will shoot two.
But yeah, Schwab took it in the lane hard, as he's very good at doing, but three bodies there, one of them a much bigger body than his, sends him straight to the floor. Rock'em sock'em basketball here.
So Carter Schwab will head to the free-throw line to shoot two shots for Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears is a team number 8 in the conference, 53.4% free-throw shooting, as Schwab has that one pop around and drop through. Friendly bounce for Schwab, and that'll make it 49-31, as Schwab is up to 9 points. 3:26 left in the third quarter. Indians came into tonight at 5-4. They were just 7-15 last season, their first losing season in well over a decade, as they will wipe off in the painted area here. Schwab looking to break into double-digit scoring tonight. Has the floor wiped off and sets up for a second free throw. It's on the way, and he swishes it. 49-32, back down to 17 as Bishop Garrigan trails. 10 points by Schwab as he leads the way for the Golden Bears tonight. Dillavue to the front court, gets to the right wing and finds Miller. Miller top of the key, jumps and passes to Clausen. Clausen works baseline, goes inside hard, and a foul. It's a blocking foul on Tate Furch. It was a question between offensive foul or blocking foul, and how quickly did Furch get there, but he'll pick it up, and that'll be his first personal.
Well, either way, Furch is going to pay the price for that. He gets up a little gingerly, limping a little bit, going to the backcourt there, but big collision on the floor as that baseline drive was hard. Furch was there. The Garrigan coaches thought he was there. Refs disagree, and they were the ones that were closest. We're way up here in the crow's nest, Tyler. We can't see that far.
No, we cannot. As the free throw's off the back of the cup, no good. But we can call it like we see it from a point-blank range.
You know, Tyler, there's 3 minutes left to go in this third quarter. I know it's a 17-point deficit depending on this free throw. But if Garrigan can get this to single digits here, it's up to 18 now as he makes the free throw. You cut this to single digits by the fourth. So, you know, try to get this down to single digits and you got a chance in the fourth.
If you can do that over the next 3 minutes, you'll have a lot of momentum, but a lot of work to be done for Garrigan. They need to be +9 over the final 3 minutes to get it down to a single-digit deficit. Joyce deals to Mahler in the left corner. Guarded by Smith. Mahler towards the lane, skids the pass out to Furch. Furch to the foul line, jumps and passes to cutting Schwab. Ball got tipped to Thomas. Thomas right under the bucket, and he sets it in.
Hey, and that's the kind of break Garrigan needs. Furch wasn't trying to pass it to Thomas, but it ricocheted right off into his hands, right for the bucket.
Thomas always finds a way to be around the basketball as Clausen gets it into Reynolds, but Thomas pokes it out of bounds. 50-34 in favor of 4-City. Indians have dropped their last three matchups against Bishop Garrigan. 4-City coming off a competitive loss against Class 3A number 2 Clear Lake. 53-42 right before winter break as a corner three is drilled by Ty Dillavue. Boy, he has burned Bishop Garrigan tonight on the three ball as he has 11 points. Schwab trying to answer back, and he does.
Oh, Garrigan needed an answer to that because Dillavue left open for that three. That one hurt. But Schwab negates it with his foul on the floor. Boy, a lot of fouls this quarter here. Call the Tate Furch on the push. That'll be his second foul.
A combined 12 fouls between these two teams during this quarter. And because both teams are in the bonus, it'll be Miller shooting two. And it comes with 2:22 on the clock. 53-37, 4-City, as Miller too strong on the first free throw. Indians will bring Holmes off the bench. And they'll bring three more players as well. They're going for big change. Blazer coming off the bench as well. Sofko and Hall, they're all checking in. And now a little confusing for the Indians on who should be in and who should be out. They will bring Dillavue out of the game, Clausen out of the game, and Smith out.
Hall will stay by the scoring table, not check in quite yet, so Indians have their five set for now. Hall looks ready to replace Miller after this free throw as Miller's free throw's up, and that one is good. Make it 54-37 for City as Miller heads to the bench and Hall checks into the ball game. Miller of 12 points leading the way for the Indians.
Well, I know Miller wanted to make that free throw and help his team out, but if he wanted to stay in the game, he needed to miss that one because Hall wouldn't have been able to check in for him had he bricked it.
Schwab, top of the key, bounce pass over to the right to Furch. Rises for a three-point ball, rims out no good, and Holmes has the box out for 4 City. Up into the front court, it's Sopko. Passes into the right corner to Blazer. Blazer driving across the lane. Hooks the left-handed shot up and missed it. Offensive board by Holmes. Holmes clean up, no good. And Thomas secures the fingertip rebound. Thomas pivots away and gets the ball out to Schwab. Schwab across the 4 City logo at half court as we're under 2 minutes left in the third quarter. 54-37, 4 City. Indians have led the whole way. Schwab just to the right of center. Schwab driving in. Schwab, tough shot, no good. Thomas following the play, turns 360. Shot block, but a foul. Thomas went to the line for two.
Schwab goes hard to the hoop, and Amari Thomas just fouled right behind him like a tailback behind a fullback, and the ball went right into his hands. Thomas gets a chance to score from the free throw line, which we don't see Thomas at the free throw line very often.
Thomas so far this season, 57% from the charity stripe. As the first free throw is up, and that one off the back of the cup, no good. Sink will check in for Bishop Garrigan as Furch heads to the bench. And Thomas will try to split the pair for the Golden Bears, sitting on 4 points right now. Second free throw is up, and Thomas drills that one to make it 54-38. In the backcourt, Sopko has it, trying to weave past Sink. Gets it into the front court, heads right down the lane, shoots the floater off the back of the cup, no good. Rebound pinballs loose, and it's picked back up by Sopko for 4 City. Indians have gotten a lot of second chances tonight. Reynolds setting the high screen for Hall. Gets to the right elbow, gives it back to Reynolds at the foul line. Reynolds takes two dribbles and shovels it to Hall in the right corner. Back of the post to Reynolds. Reynolds pivots away from Mahler, fades to the jumper, and Mahler tipped it. Good defense by the Bishop Garrigan Jr. as the Bears have the basketball with 1:08 on the clock. Schwab out to Joyce. Thomas comes up to set the screen as Joyce holds it. Joyce heads right and has Blazer on him now. Flips it back to Schwab with 57 seconds left of the quarter. Schwab with a team leading 13 points so far. Joyce with just 3 for Bishop Garrigan. Joyce gets it back. Joyce driving in. Foul line jumper on the way. Joyce got hit from behind, and that's a foul. 2 free throws coming up for the Bishop Garrigan freshman. That's now 14 fouls in this quarter combined between the teams.
Definitely a record for our broadcasting this year, Tyler. I certainly haven't watched a quarter with more fouls than this one. I don't know about you. You've been on a lot more games.
No, I certainly have not either. We have seen a ton of fouls pile up in this third. But interestingly, besides Nick Lear of 4, not a ton of other players individually in foul trouble. You've got Mahler of 3 and Miller of 3, but a lot of 1s and 2s on the scoreboard besides that, which just goes to show how deep both these teams go on the bench to rotate and keep players out of foul trouble.
Yeah, everyone's spreading it around. Sink in there right now. Schwab, Joyce, Mahler, and Thomas.
And 0-for-2 trip to the line, but I think we had a lane violation there. Joyce's second free throw came out of the cup, so he'll get a mulligan on this one and shoot again.
Yeah, Dillavu and Amari Thomas are laughing at each other right now. They were both caught leaning and pressing on each other, and they both took each other into the lane.
Joyce knocks down the free throw, so he'll cash in on the mulligan. He will split the pair and make it 54-39 as 4 City leads Bishop Garrigan. Indians have the rock right now. Hall walks it into the front court with 38 seconds left in the quarter. 11-second difference between game clock and shot clock right now. Miller bursts down the lane, hits a ton of traffic, shot no good, got his own miss back and pushes it in.
Well, I don't know how he maintained control as he went into that lane there, but good job of his footwork to avoid traveling and get his own rebound.
14 points by Miller, 11 by Hall, and 11 by Dillavu for 4 City, not to mention 9 by Sopko as they have balanced their scoring out. 14 seconds left in the quarter. Joyce puts it off the glass at a tough angle, and he somehow spun it in.
Boy, it's another circus shot there on Michael Joyce's resume, high off the glass.
Always finds a way to hit it just right as Hall, 3-point ball, and he swishes it right before the end of the quarter. Carson Hall knocks down a 3, and 4 City back up by 18. Bishop Garrigan just cannot establish any momentum, but they'll need a lot of it in the fourth. They're down 59-41 on Hometown Radio KLGA and at the Elgota Radio YouTube live stream.
We've got more sports club members making this broadcast possible on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Algona Livestock, sales every Monday.
Countryside Barbecue Sauce, two sauces for all seasons.
Farm and Home Services, view their listings at farmhomeservices.com.
Holmes Animal Clinic, animals large and small, they love them all.
Style Salon, your salon in Algona, create yourself.
Dance Connection and Tumbling by Michelle. Passionate about teaching, creative about dance. Visit their studio or danceconnectionbymichelle.com.
TAFE Wellness Center in Algona and Armstrong. Keeping athletes in the game with chiropractic care. Take charge of your health.
Signworks for all of your signage needs, as well as printed shirts, caps, and jackets. Stop in or call 295-9544.
Down to Earth Tree Service, your local Algona tree service.
Sports Club members bringing you this game.
Start of the fourth quarter right now on Hometown Radio. KLGA's Four City outscores Bishop Garrigan 20-18 during the third. Indians lead is 59-41 right now as the fourth quarter gets started. Golden Bears have the basketball, heading right to left on the radio dial as Thomas gives it off to Sink. In the lane, Mahler, center of the paint. Mahler pumps. He puts it up, and he spun it in. 11 points tonight by Drew Mahler.
Drew Mahler, second leading scorer on the Bears here, getting it going again with a nice little jump hook in the lane.
For City of basketball right now as Miller has it. Wide open free point look, left it short. Rebound is off of Thomas's hands, but he tipped it over to Mahler. And the Golden Bears will try to string some momentum together, something they have not done yet tonight. Sink looking inside. Sink going to the bucket, puts it off the window. He put it in, and he drew the foul. Trayton Sink of a chance for a three-point play.
Well, those scores can come in bunches. 59-45, don't count it out yet here. Big rallies have happened before, Tyler.
Well, what did we see in the girls' game? Bishop Garrigan was up by 15 going into the fourth. Forest City got it down to a four-point game, but Garrigan held on at the end. So we'll see if Bishop Garrigan can get a rally here in the boys' game, much like the Forest City girls did in the girls' game. Three for no good. It pinballs out of bounds. Last touched by Bishop Garrigan. Well, first 4 points of the quarter go to the Golden Bears. Forest City's lead down to 14 points as Clausen comes off the bench. And Sopko will head to the pine. Sopko may have gotten hit in the eye as he's walking towards the end of the bench and holding the side of his face.
Yeah, I think you're correct. They went up to tip that ball and maybe caught a finger in the eye.
Garrigan will try to full court press against Forest City. They inbound the ball to Hall. Guarded by Joyce as Hall brings it up the center of the court. Schwab comes over to double team him. Ball gets into Miller's hands. Now Clausen. Clausen back to the bucket, bouncing it back out to Miller. Forest City has time on their side in the fourth as 1 minute's gone here in this period. Clausen in front of the Forest City bench. Bounce pass right corner to Hall. Lob inside. Intercepted by Mahler. He fronted Delavu. Now here come the Bears. It's Schwab running up the floor. Bounce pass to Joyce. In rhythm three-pointer. And Joyce sticks it.
Whoa, quick points for the Bears. Schwab pushes the tempo. Finds his compadre Joyce. And Rosacker wants a timeout because it's already down to 11.
That is a 7-0 run to start the quarter by the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears. And a much-welcomed three-point ball by Michael Joyce. He came into tonight shooting 32% on threes, and that's his first trifecta of the evening. So all of a sudden, Beanie, you know, Forest City, they've really kind of controlled the tempo tonight. They can play fast or they can play slow, depending on what the game calls for. But now, Garrigan, they've taken a little bit of control here of the tempo starting off the fourth quarter.
Oh, yeah, just a minute 18 gone in the fourth quarter. And Garrigan has already put up some quick points. Trayton Sink with a bucket. Joyce with that three. And, boy, when you can push the tempo like Garrigan, if Forest City allows them, they can score in a hurry. And that's what I think Forest City coach says right now. Like, do not let them start getting this tempo going. We got to keep this slow in the fourth quarter so Garrigan can't score points in a hurry.
Bishop Garrigan will stick with Joyce, Schwab, Mahler, Sink, and Thomas. As Forest City has the basketball, dealing with a full-court press now by Bishop Garrigan. Ball's inbounded to Hall, and we are rolling a 6:40 on the clock here in quarter number four. That was just the first timeout taken by Forest City, so they have four left throughout the duration of the fourth period. Bishop Garrigan have two timeouts left, so they took three during the first half. Hall driving in. Hall dumps it off to Holmes. Holmes takes contact. He put it in and drew the foul. Willie Holmes with a chance for a three-point play for the Indians.
Good strong move to the hoop. Really maintained his body control as he went up to the hoop. Well, Tyler, that lead's stretching back out here. But how big was that three-pointer at the end of the third that Hall hit at the buzzer? At that point, I thought, well, it's just another three. But now Garrigan's mounting a little comeback here. If that wouldn't have dropped, it would have been even just a six-point lead.
And the free throw bounces in for Holmes. He'll finish off a three-point play. So 62-48 for City.
Joyce has the basketball for Bishop Garrigan. Golden Bears can still keep momentum with a bucket here. Joyce to the right elbow, picked away by Holmes. Joyce tries to save it, but it's now taken by Hall. Hall sidesteps Mahler. Hall puts it up, bounces off to the right, no good. Offensive rebound for Clausen, and he'll return the ball outside to Dillavu. Dillavu to Miller. Miller, three-point ball left short. Rebound Clausen. Third opportunity for Forest City, and he'll get it out to Miller. Into the post to Holmes. Holmes against Sink. Size advantage. He'll kick it out to Clausen. Wide open three. Line drive did no good, and Thomas grabs the rebound. Golden Bears dodge a major bullet on that possession. Now Joyce, corner pocket Trey, and it pops out no good. Fight for the rebound, and a jump ball. Mahler and Holmes getting tied up. Possession towards Forest City.
Well, you said it, Tyler. The Bears dodged a major bullet. Three offensive rebounds by Forest City, and they come up empty with no points. But Forest City does get the ball back after Garrigan fails to score.
Miller weaves away from Joyce and passes the Hall. Golden Bears try to trap as Hall gets into the front court. Finds Kloss, and he'll try again from the corner. Air balls. Holmes collects the rebound off the air ball. That one did not touch rim, so shot clock is down to 20 seconds as Hall backs it up near half court. Hall right of the lane. Hall bumps into Schwab, and Schwab will get called for the foul on that one as he runs into Hall. That'll be the first foul on Schwab, believe it or not. With all those fouls in the third quarter, not a single one was on Schwab.
Yeah, boy, Schwab's upset because they had the trap there. Hall was setting to jump stop, pick up his dribble, and they had that trap ready to be set. But Schwab gets called for the body contact.
Clausen will head to the bench for Forest City. Ty Dillavu in the ballgame. So right now the original five starters back in for the Indians with 5:27 on the clock. Ball is lobbed into the backcourt as Miller goes and flags it down with 5:26 left. Miller, left of the paint. Miller rising for a jumper, and it pops off the rim to the right as Lear boxes out for the rebound for Garrigan. Still 62-48. Joyce had the ball knocked away by Hall. It's off his hands and out of bounds. Hall got just enough of that ball to hit off of Joyce's leg, and then he couldn't chase it down along the near side.
Yeah, boy, Hall has got my vote for defensive player of the game for sure. He has been just dynamite all evening on the Garrigan backcourt.
We're taking down towards the five-minute mark in quarter number four as Forest City maintains control up 62-48. Bishop Garrigan started this quarter on a 7-0 run as they try to get back into it. Dillavu in the right corner, gets it to Hall. Hall, center of the paint. Hall swarmed. He'll kick it out to Miller. Miller rotates it over to Sofko. Sofko back to Miller on the left wing with 4:50 on the clock. Pass goes inside to Holmes. Holmes against Thomas. Holmes heads right, and Holmes puts it in.
Big, powerful move to the hoop. Good post play there.
9 points by Holmes. All five of Forest City starters have 9 points or more. They're all between the 9 and 14-point mark. As Joyce heads left of the paint, Joyce trying to keep that pivot foot, steps through two defenders, layup no good. Offensive board Lear, his fall is no good as well as Bishop Garrigan misses an opportunity. Quickly up before it comes Forest City, it's Hall. Hall back to the bucket, guarded by Mahler, finds the cutting Miller. Miller's floater is up and in.
Miller has such a quick release. It's why it's so hard to stop when he gets close to the hoop.
66-48 Indians. They've extended that lead all the way back up as Schwab had the ball knocked out of bounds as he went crashing to the floor. Garrigan will keep it.
Yeah, he split two defenders as he knifed through their two bodies. He hit the deck pretty hard, but he pops right back up.
Well, after all the work to get it back down to 11, all of a sudden, 18-point lead by the Indians with 4:07 left. As we're going to have a floor wiping timeout here right underneath the bucket.
Well, Tyler, when they cut that lead, it was because of some quick, fast-paced tempo play by Garrigan, converting fast breaks into buckets. And Coach Rosacker for Forest City called timeout. And since then, they were able to stem any sort of Garrigan tempo.
Schwab bounce pass into Mahler. That's a good point. That was a good timeout by Forest City as Mahler gets in the lane. Right-handed hook is up and it's through.
He's showing a quick release of his own, Mahler with a quick little jump hook.
66-50, 13 points by Mahler. He and Schwab tied for the lead on Bishop Garrigan right now. As Forest City gets into the front court of Hall, he finds Miller. Miller, 3:49 left, pivots 3:60, and gets it out to Dillavu. Dillavu to the paint, top of the key, Miller. Rises for a three-point try, and he swishes it. Big shot again by Miller. 19-point lead by Forest City. 19 points as well by Miller tonight. In the paint, Lear takes one dribble, floats it up with the right hand, and puts it in. 2 points for Nick Lear, and a stoppage as Mahler lost a shoe.
Well, it's very kind of the referee to let him put a shoe back on. You're going to let him tie it as well.
See, everyone in the holiday spirit. Some of that Christmas spirit is left over, Beanie.
You know, I think a lot of kids got some new shoes for Christmas. I see a lot of new kicks out there running around in both the girls' game and the boys' game. Everyone's probably getting blisters tonight on their brand-new shoes.
You've got to break them in at some point, and tonight is the night for that. As Miller gets into the front court, or make that Hall gets into the front court as he weaves past Schwab. Hall sidestepping, he's floating. Line drived it, no good. Rebound is tracked down by Lear, and he gets to Schwab. Did you get any new shoes, Beanie, as it gets inside to Mahler? Mahler puts the two in.
Wow, and Dillavu skied and tried to slap the backboard, but Mahler puts it through anyway. Tyler, I did get new shoes. I get new shoes every Christmas. That's how fortunate I am.
Oh, man, you are a lucky man, Beanie Bodie, getting those fresh kicks for Christmas as we're down to 2:55 left. 69-54 for City.
But I asked for ones that would make me run faster, but so far it's not working.
So you're saying it involves the person more than the shoes?
No, it's the shoes' fault.
Ball's tipped away. Thomas picks it up in the lane as Forest City turns it over and gives it back to Garrigan with 2:38 left. Shot is up. It rolls around, and it drops through. That'll make it 69-56, as that's now 11 points by Michael Joyce and a quick timeout by Garrigan. They will have one timeout left.
I don't know how Michael Joyce made that shot. He chucked it up at the rim as he was falling to the ground. Somehow it still manages to go in as he's sliding across the floor. What another circus shot by Joyce. Boy, his 11 points have not been easy. He had one open three-point shot that he knocked down, and the other 8 points of his have come at a high amount of effort, as the Forest City defense has done a really nice job all night. On both Schwab and Joyce, they're going to go home from this game pretty sore and tired.
Well, that's the thing. How many times, not just tonight, but really throughout the whole season, will we say and have we said, how did Joyce possibly make that shot? I mean, he shoots from just about everywhere. Like you said, Forest City, they've devoted a ton of energy to him tonight. Held him off the board in the first half, and now he has 11 here in the second half. But scoring-wise, taking Joyce and Schwab away earlier was a big key for Forest City. Another thing, too, pretty quiet night for Logan Nemers, coming off a huge night against St. Edmund right before the break.
Yeah, he had a huge night against St. Ed's, and then this whole team had a huge night against North Union before the break. And I'm sure this wasn't the way they wanted to start it off, but, you know, sometimes this Forest City matchup, Garrigan just tends not to play super in this gym.
69-56 Forest City. They break the press and get it across the hall with 2:29 left. Hall lobs near side to Miller, who jumps and catches, and he gives it to Dillavu. Back to Miller. Two players run at him, and Miller has his pass knocked away by Lear. Gets it up ahead to Joyce, and then Hall peels away from Joyce, and Joyce grabs the jersey for a foul. A frustration foul by Michael Joyce, and Bishop Garrigan will give it back to Forest City of 2:17 left. That's personal foul number three against Joyce, and team foul number three of the quarter by Bishop Garrigan. Clawson enters the ballgame as Hall heads to the bench. 14 points tonight for the Indians, as Hall will take a seat on the pine. Dillavu from the baseline. Dillavu looking. Dillavu running out of time, and there's the five count. They did not call timeout, and that'll be a turnover by Forest City.
Dillavu saying he called timeout, and the referee says, well, you got to say it louder than that if you want me to issue it.
Schwab and Mendelier finds Joyce. Left wing three-pointer way short, and the rebound gets away from Garrigan as it's taken by Sopko. Taking down towards the 2:10 mark, Miller gets into the front court. Miller stops the dribble, being pestered by Joyce. Miller run over the line. It's an over-and-back violation. Good defense by Michael Joyce.
Yeah, Joyce put up a wall there. He used the mid-court line as a barrier, and Miller had nowhere to step backwards.
Smith will check out of the game as Hall comes back in for Forest City. Garrigan has the basketball down 69-56. Garrigan will be back in action Friday night against West Hancock, Forest City. We'll face Lake Mills on Friday night as Joyce underhands it out to Lear. Back to Joyce. Joyce has the ball get away from him. It pinballs back and forth between him and Miller, and Miller ends up with the rock with 1:52 left.
Boy, there's a lot of fight in Michael Joyce. He is still trying with everything he's got to get in there and score, play defense here.
Well, the Indians looking for win number 6 of the season after getting just 7 wins last year. They have the basketball right now. Pass intended for Clawson, intercepted by Lear. Golden Bears have to hurry here as Schwab, with 1.5 minutes left, gets towards the baseline. Schwab into the paint. Ball peeled away, but a foul. It'll go against Clawson, the second team foul on Forest City of the quarter. And Joyce kind of keeled over in front of the Garrigan bench with his hands on his knees. That is an exhausted player, Beanie, and one coming off of a long winter break of not regular season game actions, but maybe a little scrimmaging for Garrigan.
Yeah, he has put in some work tonight here. Schwab inbounds to Thomas.
He'll find Joyce with 1:27 left. Back to Schwab. into the post to Thomas, and a foul by Four City as they push against Thomas and pick up their third foul.
Yeah, Thomas is just holding his own there, and Clausen had a knee right in his backside, refusing to give any ground, and gets called for the push. Fouls still mounting up, even though for the most part I think this game is out of reach unless Garrett can come up with 13 points real quick.
And ball's intercepted. Schwamm's inbound pass to Joyce is taken away by Hall. Hall, like you said, of a huge defensive night as Garrigan tries to press. Dillavu has the ball right now, and Forest City will get called for 10 seconds. They never even got close to half court that time.
No.
And I don't know if the shot clock was right there. That was a quick 10 seconds.
Yeah, the shot clock says down to 24, but Coach Rosacker is pleading his case saying that couldn't have been 10 seconds. I didn't think it was 10 seconds. I didn't think they were anywhere close to it. But whatever the case, hey, the clock does not lie. And it had 24 on it, started at 35, so that's 11.
Golden Bears have the basketball back following the 10-second call. Schwab left open for a three-point try. Off the back of the cup, ball deflects towards the far side, and that'll be foul number five against Lear. Lear will foul out as he was scrapping with Dillavu for the basketball.
Just both of them trying to chase down a rebound. And, boy, neither of these teams are conceding the game here. It's a 13-point margin, 1 minute left, and both teams are playing like the game is on the line. So it's fun to see some scrappiness in some high school teams, but it's going to be a little too late for Bishop Garrigan.
Sink will replace Lear for the Golden Bears with 1:03 left in this one, and a 69-56 score. Dillavuta inbound, gets it into Clausen near side of the court. Clausen across half court, passes away from Mahler and avoids trouble, as he'll find Sofko with 58 seconds left. Golden Bears will drop to 6-5 on the season as a timeout is called by Coach Rosacker, trying to get things in order here before the end of the game, as he'll take a 30-second timeout.
Yeah, he just wasn't going to let his player get trapped there, even though likely going to carry on for the win here. Coach Rosacker doesn't like to see his player get trapped there up against the sideline. And use that timeout if you got it.
Well, Bishop Garrigan looks set to drop to 6-5 on the season. I'll ask you this, Beanie. Are you a big New Year's resolution guy?
No, I am not, Tyler. I used to be, and then I realized it only results in misery later on when you realize you failed. So
well, hopefully the point I'm leading to doesn't fail. I was about to ask you, what's your New Year's resolution for this Bishop Garrigan basketball team?
Oh, you know what? I will say, like I mentioned earlier with my shoes, I want to be faster. And maybe that's the motto for the Garrigan team, too. They need to stay in the games earlier and get in the game faster because they sure are trying hard right now. But I think they're going to wish they would have had this kind of effort earlier in the game.
Yeah, starting faster definitely could be a big key. Even in a win, like a North Union game, Garrigan started slow in that one, but they came back to win, which would be the difference between that night and tonight. Dillavu down to the baseline, gets it out to Miller with 8 seconds on the shot clock, down to 34 on the game clock. Schwab against Miller. Pass goes into the right corner to Sofko. Catch and shoot three, no good. Hall sails in, can't get the foul to go. Rebound gets loose, and it's taken by Mahler. Mahler outlets to Joyce. Joyce flies down the floor, takes a hard bump by Miller, and Joyce will shoot two.
Joyce at 11 points right now in double digits, going to try to get himself to 13 with two shots here.
Joyce ranking number 6 in the top of Iowa West in points per game, coming into tonight at 16.2. As he will shoot two free throws with 22.7 seconds left. Holmes will get set to check in for Forest City as Joyce drains the first foul shot and makes it 69-57.
You know, clearly some upset players out there, I'd say, on both teams. Not everyone's playing the game that they thought they were going to play coming after a practice, a week of practices here over the Christmas break or so. And, boy, a lot of ferocity out there. I think that bodes well for both teams. These teams, they are playing tough all the way to the final bell.
69-58, Four Cities. Joyce knocks down both free throws. He has 13 points tonight. Indians will try to get it across half court before 10 seconds, and they do up to Clausen. Clausen at 13 seconds bounces it down to Holmes, and now Forest City will just try to keep the ball safe here for the final 8 seconds. Holmes in the paint gets it outside to Hall with the final 5 seconds ticking away. Joyce will try to get a steal right before the buzzer, but Hall keeps the ball away from Joyce, and that'll bring it to the final buzzer as Forest City starts fast early, and they hang on to defeat Bishop Garrigan by a final count of 69-58. Coming out of winter break, Indians improve their record to 6-4 on the season, and they are now 6-1 in top of Iowa West play. Golden Bears dropped to 6-5 overall, and they are 4-3 in the conference. We will step aside right now for a quick timeout and wrap up our broadcast coming up next on 92.7 KLGA and at the Algona Radio YouTube live stream.
High school sports on Hometown and Home Country Radio are brought to you by these fine sports club members.
Farmer State Bank is proud to be part of our community. Offices in Algona, Whittemore, and West Bend.
Stroman Dental, giving you something to smile about.
Bill's Auto and Truck Repair. Service is the difference.
Trend Salon, your complete family hair salon. It's all about you.
Oakcrest Funeral Services, celebrating a life lived.
Algona Frame and Auto Body, we meet by accident.
Water Connection, from softeners to bottled water and service, call 295-SOFT.
Algona Pizza Ranch, there's so much to love.
Cotton Grave Farm Management and Land Realty in downtown Algona, trusted for farmland service needs since 1960.
Sponsoring this broadcast on Hometown and Home Country Radio.
Wrapping up game number one, coming out of winter break as the Four City Indians defeat the Bishop Garrigan Golden Bears 69-58. Four City got off to a big 14-3 start early in the ballgame, and they never looked back, defeating the Golden Bears to improve to 6-4 on the season and 6-1 in top of Iowa West play. The scoring by quarter went like this. Four City had a 20-13 scoring advantage in the first and a 19-10 scoring advantage in the second, going up 39-23 at the half. Indians had a 20-18 advantage in the third quarter as they led 59-41 going into the fourth. Golden Bears had a 17-10 scoring edge in quarter number four, but it would not be enough as the Bears dropped to 6-5 on the season and 4-3 in the conference. The individual scoring leaders for Bishop Garrigan were Drew Mahler with 15 points and Carter Schwab and Michael Joyce both with 13. On the Four City side of things, you had Tommy Miller scoring 19, Carson Hall with 14, Ty Dillavue with 11, Ty Sopko and Willie Holmes both with 9, as all five Four City starters ended up with 9 or more points. Again, I'm Tyler Lance alongside my partner Beanie Bodie. Beanie, I'll start with this. This is a well-balanced Four City team, and going into this game, you looked at the top of the conference, you saw Lake Mills, you saw North Union, and it kind of made sense why both of those teams were there. Lake Mills team, of course, that's always at the top of the conference, and a North Union team that really brings back all their talent from last year to challenge Lake Mills. And you saw Forest City there as well, and you kind of asked, well, Forest City had kind of an off year last year. How are they at the top of the conference right now? And I'd say really a well-balanced team. I mean, they can score for all five players in their starting lineup. They can shoot the three. They can shoot from mid-range. They can score on the paint. It's just a well-balanced team overall, and overall they started fast against Garrigan tonight and really never looked back after that point.
Yeah, you told the whole story just with your scoring recount. Having that many players in near double-digit scoring, talk about balance. If you're playing defense against that team, good luck, because everyone can score and they move the ball around well. Really tough to defend against Four City. But talking about their defense, I think that's really what set the tone for the game. Hall was a great defender the whole game. Tommy Miller did a nice job as well. But you look at Garrigan and you look at their stats and you come in and you see Schwab and Joyce putting up some crazy numbers, lots of scoring. And Forest City said, well, we're gonna send the whole kitchen sink at those guys. Every time Joyce and Schwab tried to turn a corner and drive into the lane, there were two, sometimes three bodies right there for them to truck through they did. Like, Schwab hit the ground several times. Joyce had a hard time ever getting close to the rim. They really kept those guys out. And so much of Garrigan's scoring happens from those two guys, or those two guys finding Lear, Thomas, Nemers, Mueller underneath. And take that away, and Garrigan, you know, struggled to get things going offensively. You know, it's impressive Schwab and Joyce still managed to get double-digit scoring there. Drew Mueller stepped up big in that first half, hit three three-pointers in that first half, keeping Garrigan alive. But they didn't quite have that balanced scoring they needed to match Four City's balance.
You're right. They didn't have the balanced scoring. And like you said, even though the final numbers ended up good for Schwab and Joyce, the thing was they started slow in this game while Bishop Garrigan as a team was starting slow. Joyce did not have any points in the first half, and Schwab did score a little bit in the first half. He had 6 or 9 at the break. I think it was 6. But ultimately, they did a lot of their scoring in the second half, but that was a point where Garrigan was down pretty much between 10 and 20 for the entire second half as they tried to work back into it. The other point you made that I thought was an important one was, you know, a lack of scoring from the post players by Bishop Garrigan, and really just a good job defensively for Forest City to take that away. We saw against St. Edmund a ton of scoring in the paint led by Logan Nemers, but of course, if you're Garrigan, you always have Amari Thomas and Nick Lear coming off the bench to provide, you know, from that center spot as well. But tonight, you know, 5 points by Amari Thomas. I think Nick Lear ended up with 4 points. And it was a quiet night for Logan Nemers as well, single-digit scoring. So a lot of that inside weaponry that Garrigan usually uses didn't have a lot of points in tonight's game.
Yeah, and credit that defense to Forest City. They were able to stop the drive and then get back, defend the hoop. Reynolds had a lot of height inside. He's a shot-blocking presence. He was there all night wreaking havoc inside. And just a bad matchup for Garrigan. But, you know, you got to flush this one. I'm sure that's what the coaches are telling the boys in the locker room. They don't – I don't know why it is. Like, certain teams just don't play well in certain gyms. And over the years, this has been one of the gyms that the Garrigan boys, regardless of the season, just haven't played their best in, win, lose, or draw. It just hasn't been a great gym for the Garrigan Bears. And so, got to flush this one. You'll get another chance at Forest City later in the season.
You will. When we talked about this after the girls' game, one of the Bishop Garrigan won, is that Forest City cannot wait to play Bishop Garrigan again later in the year. Well, I'd say Bishop Garrigan is really going to be looking forward to playing Forest City again and seeing if they can fix what went wrong in tonight's game as they fall to 4-3 in conference play. That'll be it for tonight's broadcast. Our next Bishop Garrigan game for you is coming up on Friday night as the Golden Bears host West Hancock in a big top of Iowa West rivalry matchup, as that one will start at 6 o'clock with the pregame and 6:15 with the opening tip-off. That'll be it for our broadcast for tonight. Big thank you to all our video streaming sponsors here on the Algona Radio YouTube page, sports club members and sponsors as well, and everyone back at the studio helping keep things in order for us. For my partner Beanie Bodie, I'm Tyler Lance, signing off as once again the final score, Forest City 69 and Bishop Garrigan 58.